in the back for that cause. So we'll begin with the introductions. Our pro-fluoridation debater is Boyne City resident Dave Fierstein.
Close enough.
I'm sorry if I got that wrong. Dave has worked for over 20 years with water distribution and wastewater systems in the United States and abroad. He is a former water operations foreman for the United States Department of Defense in Afghanistan, and he is currently the water operations manager for the city of East Jordan. Dave, what Dave says here today is strictly his thoughts, are strictly his thoughts, and do not necessarily represent the thoughts of any other person, entity, organization, or group. So please welcome Dave. That's what I thought. And then everybody told me it was the other way.
They did.
Yes. Sorry, Dave. Okay, our anti-fluoridation debater is Paul Connett, PhD. Dr. Connett received his bachelor's degree from Cambridge University in England. He received his PhD in chemistry from Dartmouth College in New Hampshire. He taught at St. Lawrence University in Canton, New York, where he taught for 23 years. His specialty was environmental chemistry and toxicology. He began researching the issue of fluoride's toxicity relating to fluoridation in 1996. He is the executive director of the Fluoride Action Network and is co-author of the book, The Case Against Fluoride, How Hazardous Waste Wound Up in Our Drinking Water, and The Bad Science and Powerful Politics that Keep It There. Please welcome Dr. Connett. The format will be as follows. Beginning with the pro-fluoridation debater, each debater will present a 15-minute PowerPoint presentation. After that, the first round, Dave gets a 7-minute speech, after which Paul has 5 minutes to debate, to ask questions of Dave. Then Paul will give a 7-minute speech, after which Dave has 5 minutes to ask questions of Paul. The second round, Dave gives a 4-minute speech. Paul has 5 minutes to ask questions of Dave. And Paul gives a 4-minute speech, and Dave has 5 minutes to ask questions of Paul. We think this gives a lot of information. I will be asking no questions. They will be talking about what they want to talk about. Finally, the summation, each debater will give a 5-minute summation. After that, we will open the floor to questions. Any questions you have will be taken. Will be taken questions from Dave, then a question from Paul. Question from Dave, we'll do it like that. So, let's begin.
Before we start, I want to take just a minute and move my podium up just a floor so I can see the screen.
Oh, yeah.
Good, thank you.
Your mic on?
Yeah.
Can't hear you back
here
very good.
No. Radio is running on important
enough. Oh, you're just going off my voice, so I'll have to speak loud. And before I start, I'd like to thank my wife for challenging me during this process and helping me to focus on what I was going to do here today. And while I was getting ready, she said, probably haven't wanted to back out of anything this long since we I'd also like to thank Dr. Connett for coming here all the way from New York just to make my day. I think about 500 other places I'd rather be right now. Okay, you start the clock. The citizens of Boyne City will have to make a decision about water fluoridation in a few weeks. Of course, fluoridating water
the optimal levels of 0.7 to 1.2 parts per million is a proven health benefit, and that it helps to prevent tooth decay. In an email to me, the national fluoridation engineer at the CDC said, every systematic scientific panel that has looked at the use of fluoride in drinking water worldwide have been in agreement that it is safe, healthy, and effective. There's a very vocal minority who is determined that fluoride stay out of the Boyne City water supply. And they are so determined that they brought in a professional debater, Dr. Paul Conant from New York, which in itself should raise some red flags. Dr. Conant has had 18 years and over 5,000 studies on fluoride from which he can cherry-pick data and statistics to support his marginal conclusions. You, Dr. Conant, who've never drank water from the Boyne City water system until perhaps today, sent a letter to the Boyne City Gazette criticizing a local citizen whose home does use Boyne City water for refusing to debate you about what should or should not go into his water. He apparently didn't want to give undue legitimacy to someone whom 99.936% of healthcare and other professionals in this country don't take seriously. In your letter of criticism toward him, you said, quote, this is a pretty lame excuse. Surely if that were the case, I would be easy meat for him in open public debate. He could simply run down the list of where I've been misleading or irrelevant, and I would be forced to reply. If I could not do so, then he clearly would win the debate. Well, sir, this is what you've asked for, so I'll do what I can to make that happen. Now, there really isn't enough time to go through every example where you've been misleading, but maybe we can take a look at a few examples and see if there's a pattern with you. Okay, Dr. Conant claims that the CDC does not want you to know the truth about fluoride. And I wanted to take a closer look at this, so I went to the webpage, Fluoride Action Network webpage. The very first thing I came across was this letter from the then National Director, from the National Fluoride Engineer. This was from 2001. And if you're listening at home and you have a computer, you can go to the Fluoride Action Network, type in CDC on their search engine. This is the first letter that will come up. Dr. Conant writes, after many months of waiting, Thomas Reeves, the CDC's water engineer responsible for overseeing the U.S. fluoridation program, has responded to questions about chemicals used in fluoridating water. Now listen carefully to what Dr. Conant says here. Quote, one interesting concession made by Reeves in this letter is that all fluoridation chemicals, including sodium fluoridate, are waste products of the phosphate fertilizer industry. Now here, okay, and that's signed Paul Conant. Now here is the quote by Mr. Reeves to which Dr. Conant is referring. Okay, on the same page, about an inch below Conant's introduction, quote, all the fluoride chemicals used in the U.S. for water fluoridation, are byproducts of the phosphate fertilizer industry. And he goes on to use the word byproduct again in describing the manufacture of fluoride products. Never once in this letter does Mr. Reeves use the word waste product. These are two different words with two different meanings, and Dr. Conant knows this because he is a self-described authority on waste management. A waste product is, noun, a material discarded as useless in the process or of producing something. An example of this would be carbon monoxide from your car. That's a waste product. A byproduct, a noun, is a secondary or incidental product that's in the process of manufacture. For example, wood pellets from lumber, leather from the cattle industry. So if I was to do what he did, I would say the leather in Dr. Conant's shoes are waste products of the cattle murdering industry because, you know, you want to make it sound as horrible as possible. Now, what really blows me away about this is that this misquotation is on the same page, about 2 inches below the actual quote. And what this says to me is that this guy has so little respect for the intelligence of his readers that he thinks they are so stupid he can misquote someone on the same page where the actual quote is. If he has that kind of audacity, imagine what he thinks he can get away with when you have to look it up and verify it. Every time this man quotes someone, it first needs to be doubted, then scrutinized, then verified, because he does not have a good track record when it comes to accurately quoting people. Not only does Mr. Reeves not concede that all fluoride products are actually waste products, but they actually are not waste products. Fluorosilic acid, which is what Boyne City used for fluoridation, has many other uses, although you wouldn't know it if you visited his website, because they want to convince you that the only way that they can get rid of fluorosilic acid is in your drinking water. Other uses for fluorosilic acid include solar panel fabrication, computer chip fabrication, glass etching, and chemical feedstock for producing other chemicals. These are not waste. This is not a waste product. This is a byproduct. So to misquote someone is a lie immediately, and to say that the fluoride products are waste products is a second lie. But let's not stop there. Dr. Khanna has often complained that his critics have not read his book. And I have to tell you, sir, over in East Jordan, not far from here, the city council did read your book. And they voted 4-2 against you. And this is a copy, get it out here, this is a copy of chapter 25 of Paul Conant's book, Case Against Fluoride. Excuse me. Okay.
There's a page on the floor.
No, that's not it. I'm sorry. Bear with me. Okay. This is a copy of chapter 25 of Dr. Conant's book, and this chapter was given to the East Jordan City Council when an anti-fluoride activist gave it to them. So I think it's fair to consider this a good example of his work. Oops. Okay. I think it's a good example of his work because this is what they wanted him, they wanted the City Council to see. I'm not going to go through and cherry-pick things like Dr. Conant does with studies. To be fair to Dr. Conant, I'm going to only look at the first two pages, the first 5 minutes of my reading, to show you how Dr. Conant presents a logical argument. Before I get into my argument, I want to zoom in on the second paragraph here. Okay. And did you ever notice that when someone is on really shaky ground, they really try to push a point home? And in this one small paragraph, he uses the word medicine or medication 5 times. Does it look like he's trying to convince you of something? Overkill. Anyway, now that that's... Okay. Now, what he's done in this chapter is he presents these arguments that proponents of fluoridation use, and then he argues against those statements. So, for example, number one. There's no difference in principle between chlorination and fluoridation. That's the pro-fluoridation argument. Then his answer to that is, this is wrong. Chlorination treats water. Fluoridation treats people. Of course, he's playing word games here. The simple fact and the physical reality is that both chlorine and fluoride go into the water, and fluoride and chlorine go into your body. And Dr. Richard Feynman at the Space Shuttle Challenger disaster hearing said, you can't fool nature. And you can't fool reality with word games. I could also accurately say both chlorination and fluoridation exist for the betterment of humanity. But that's beside the point. I'm just going to read what he says here. Water is treated with chlorine to make the water safe to drink. It kills bacteria and other vectors that carry disease. Chlorination is not without its critics, but millions of lives have been saved by this process. So he's saying chlorination is a good thing. It makes water safe to drink, and I completely agree with this. Now, Dr. Conant knows that chlorine is so dangerous that it's been used as a weapon of war. Is also considered a weapon of mass destruction. In fact, a canister of chlorine gas, like the ones used in large water treatment plants like Houston, are so deadly that if one were to leak and erupt, it would kill everyone within a city block. And he knows this because he's a smart guy. He also knows that chlorine is added in such minute amounts, about one part per million, that it won't hurt you. He knows this because he says right here, it makes water safe to drink. Now, let's jump over to number five, claim number five on page two. Claim number five says, the amount of fluoride added to the public water system, one part per million, is so small it couldn't possibly hurt you. Does it sound familiar? Again, this is the pro-fluoride argument. One part per million is so small it couldn't possibly hurt you, which you will now argue against. Yet in claim number one, he defended the use of chlorine, which, if you will remember, is put in at doses so small, about one part per million, that it couldn't possibly hurt you. Okay. So let's see what his argument against this is. First, he uses language taken from the EPA Direct Consumer Confidence Report that all water systems are required to send to their customers. Quote, promoters use analogies such as one part per million is equivalent to 1 cent in $10,000 or 1 inch in 16 miles, unquote. Now, the Consumer Confidence Report, which water customers receive annually, this language is used to describe all contaminants in drinking water, not just fluoride. And he goes on to say, quote, such analogies are nonsensical without reference to the toxicity of the chemical in question. Now, the part I like right here is, quote, for example, one part per million is about a million times higher than the safe concentration to swallow of dioxin. I just copied and pasted that. The awkward language is his. And 100 times higher than the safe drinking water standard for arsenic. I'll read that again without his awkward language. One, quote, one part per million is about a million times higher than the safe concentration of dioxin and 100 times higher than the safe drinking water standard for arsenic. Now remember, these statements are made in the context of his argument against the fact that one part per million of fluoride is safe. So the twisted logic of his argument is this. I can't say that a quantity of something is safe because a lesser amount of something else is unsafe. We can't say that one part per million of fluoride is safe because a million times less that amount of dioxin is unsafe. We can't say that a bowl of oatmeal is safe because a teaspoon of rat poison is unsafe. Now, I'm not Spock, but his logic is a joke. And if it turns out, it turns out not to be just me. Other people have found problems with Dr. Conant's stuff, too. And the one on the bottom, try to see if this thing moves. I don't know if you can read that, but it says, Dr. Conant misrepresents my study as an analysis of the benefits of water fluoridation, which it was not. He also misrepresents the study's indirect evidence on the benefits of water fluoridation on decay. And this was written by Dr. John Spencer, Battling University, in 2005. And I guess they don't like it when you represent their studies. You know, who knew? The second one from the top, this one, which I guess you guys can't read that, Conant often relies on studies of fluoride used in other countries, where concentrations are significantly higher. One of Conant's main assertions that fluoride is a dangerous, unregulated, industrial waste byproduct is disputed by public health professionals and was examined by PolitiFact.com, which found the assertion false. That was the Syracuse, New York Standard Post in 2012. The next one down, quote, in our opinion, information that Dr. Paul Conant presents to the public about fluoridation is unreliable. In particular, he misleads through exaggeration and misrepresentation of studies and analysis. And that's the Institute of Science and Medicine, October 2012. And there's that phrase again, misrepresentation of studies. It seems to be a common theme with him. Okay, I'm going to switch gears here and take advantage of picture time and show you some pictures of what water fluoridation is all about. This is tooth decay. I couldn't find any pictures of tooth decay on the Fluoride Action Network. That's not to say they're not there, I just couldn't find them. And I don't think Dr. Conant is going to show you these pictures, because this is the heart of the issue right here. So I'll show them to you. And if you're listening at home, you can Google images of tooth decay. That's pretty much what we're looking at here, although I got these images from the Michigan Department of Community Health with their permission. According to Delta Dental Insurance Company, tooth decay is still topping the list as the most common chronic childhood disease in the nation. On a national scale, it is estimated that children miss 51 million hours of school each year because of problems with their teeth. In addition, adults miss 164 million hours of work each year because of time spent dealing with their own dental health issues. Laura Zalada, president and CEO of Delta Dental Insurance Company, says that, quote, poor oral health can have life-altering effects on a person. Educating people on the importance of good oral health and its connection to overall health can significantly improve a child's preparedness to learn in the classroom. Access to health care can mean the difference between a student graduating from high school or whether or not an adult gets a job, Salata said. Needless to say, Delta Dental fiercely supports water fluoridation to the tune of giving away about $1 million a year in grant money for water fluoridation programs. And this is why. Now, when I was in Afghanistan, I saw a lot of this. It's definitely not good. I think we in America have kind of forgotten why the CDC and the American Dental Association and over 100 other health organizations worldwide support water fluoridation. This is why. Take a look at these pictures. And that's all I have.
We're going to need a few minutes just to change over the connection to my laptop.
I forgot to mention that there will be a single bell warning sound a minute before your time is up.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry, and then there'll be a double bell when your time is up, and you can finish your sentence. You know.
Okay.
I'd rather leave some dead space here. Let me start by thanking David very much for agreeing to this debate. In 18 years, I've had perhaps six debates, And you have more courage than the vast majority of dentists in this country who speak very confidently of this practice, but when they're challenged to debate, they refuse to do so. But you have accepted the challenge, and I respect you for that.
Thank you.
And I'd also like to thank you. I also would like to thank you for graciously not making my life very difficult this afternoon. I had prepared, I added up all the time, the 17 plus 5 plus 5, and I was going to give my PowerPoint throughout that whole period. And when I checked the rubric here, it says PowerPoint for the first presentation and then speech afterwards. I had not seen that. I hadn't made that distinction. But David has allowed me to use my PowerPoint throughout, which is what I planned, and I appreciate that. It was very gracious of you. Okay, have we switched over to the...
Thanks.
All right, you're ready with the clock. I don't know, we're not getting them. Don't start the clock yet. Let me see what's happening with my computer.
Need to turn it.
There you go.
Yeah. There we are.
Thank you.
We can have the light off now. Okay, we're ready to go. The first thing, David has done what many promoters of fluoridation do, and that is to assume that there's nothing wrong with the practice, there's something wrong with the opponents of fluoridation. So basically, most of his speech is trying to discredit me or make you feel that I misrepresent the data and so on. But I want to get down to, I would hope at some point he would give a cogent argument for why you have to put fluoride in the water. That's what I thought the pro-fluoridation debate would be. As already indicated, I spent 18 years researching this issue, first as a professor of environmental chemistry and toxicology, and now as the director of the Fluoride Action Network. And yes, in 2010, that resulted in this book. Not my book, our book. There are three scientists who authored this book, co-authored this book, James Beck, PhD, MD, and Spedding Micklem, a PhD in biology. So if you've got a problem with the book, then you have a problem with all three of us. I happen to respect my colleagues very well, and they did a masterful job of not overstating the issue. This is published, there are copies at the back. Every single argument is documented with 80 pages of references to the scientific literature. In 4 years since this publication, there's been no written response from the proponents of fluoridation. If the other side had produced a book like this, we would have produced a response in a few weeks. I will argue that fluoridation is unusual, unnatural, unethical, unnecessary, unsafe, ineffective, and there are better ways to fight tooth decay in low-income families, which has been demonstrated in places like Scotland. So fluoridation is unusual. The vast majority of countries do not fluoridate their water, including 97% of Western Europe. Four of those countries fluoridate their salt, but the majority of European countries neither fluoridate their water nor their salt. However, according to the World Health Organization, data, tooth decay in 12-year-olds is coming down as fast. This is the rate with which tooth decay has been coming down in these countries, which have over 50% of their populations drinking fluoridated water. And if you just looked at that, you'd think that fluoridation is doing a great job. However, if you look at the rate of decrease of same indices, tooth decay in 12-year-olds, it's coming down as fast, if not faster, in all those non-fluoridated countries. If you put them all together, it's a wash. And if you look down here, you can't tell the difference whether that 12-year-old has grown up in a fluoridated or non-fluoridated country. Fluoridation is unnatural. Fluoridation promoters stress that fluoride is naturally occurring, sometimes even using the word fluoridation, nature thought of it first. They are confusing geology with biology. The level of fluoride that occurs in water is a vagary of which rocks the water has flown through. That's nothing to do with biology. But nature has got something to say about this. But first of all, before we go into that, just because something occurs naturally in water doesn't make it safe. Arsenic occurs naturally in water, but doesn't make it safe. And millions of people worldwide have had their health damaged by both fluoride and arsenic. So nature has passed a verdict on fluoride. The verdict is as follows. Nature, the level of fluoride in mother's milk is very, very low. So nature's determined after millions or thousands of years of experimentation that the baby does not need fluoride. And in fact, a bottle-fed baby in a fluoridated community in the United States is getting between 175 and 300 times more fluoride than nature intended. So mother's milk protects our babies from fluoride. We are circumventing that protection by putting fluoride in the tap water. Fluoridation is unethical. We should never use the public water supply to deliver any medical treatment. We've never done it with anything else, but other people now suggesting lithium and statins to put in the water, absolute nonsense. And the reason is, once you put the water, the medicine in the water, whatever you want to call it, into the water, you cannot control the dose, you cannot control who gets it, it goes to everybody, and it violates the individual's right to informed consent to medication. So in other words, you're allowing the community to do to everyone what a doctor, individual doctor, can do to nobody in your community. Force an individual to take medicine or human treatment without their informed consent. Fluoridation is being prescribed and administered by people with no medical training. No agency is monitoring side effects. No agency is measuring exposure levels. And some individuals should not be exposed to fluoride. People with poor kidney function who can't get rid of as much fluoride as normal people, and people with borderline or outright iodine deficiency, about 12 million people in the United States. That will make fluoride worse for their thyroid gland. No agency accepts responsibility for harm if and when it is demonstrated. He listed 100, he's referred to 100 organizations that endorse fluoridation. Not one single one of those agencies accepts any responsibility for harm that may be caused. Health agencies in fluoridated countries are doing a very poor job conducting health studies. No health agency has attempted to put the issue of some individuals being sensitive to fluoride, which is exactly what you would expect. If a substance has toxic effects at high doses, you expect some people to be sensitive at low doses. Not being investigated. I've said that already. Health agencies are not doing epidemiological studies in children using the severity of dental fluorosis, which is a very convenient and obvious biomarker for exposure. All this despite the fact that there is no scientific reason to swallow fluoride. There is not one single biochemical process in the body that needs fluoride. None. Therefore, it's not an essential nutrient. So to force this onto people is absolute nonsense. Fluoridation is unnecessary. In 1999, the Center for Disease Control conceded that the predominant benefit of fluoride is topical, not systemic. In other words, it works on the outside of the teeth, not from inside the body. This is what they said. Fluoride carries preventive properties initially were attributed to changes in enamel during tooth development. However, laboratory and epidemiologic research suggests that fluoride prevents dental caries predominantly after eruption of the teeth into the mouth, and its actions are primarily topical. Well, this admission by CDC should have ended fluoridation there and then, because if fluoride works primarily on the outside of the tooth, not from inside the body, why swallow fluoride and expose every tissue in the body to a known toxic substance when you can brush it on your teeth and spit it out? And toothpaste is universally available. And why put it in the drinking water and force it on people who don't want it? I'm going to come to that in a moment. Fluoridation is unsafe. There are many biological processes that are harmed by fluoride. That's why the first opponents of fluoride were biochemists. Fluoride inhibits enzymes, switches on G proteins. There's a good summary of that data in Barbier et al. From 2010. Bottle-fed babies in fluoridated communities are exceeding the EPA's safe reference dose. Now for this, look at figure 2.8 on page 85 of the National Research Council report from 2006. This is it. Took them 3.5 years to write that. It's 500 pages, 1,100 references. Here's the figure on page, figure 2.8 on page 85. What this does is to show the average fluoride intake for various age ranges drinking fluoridated water. There it is again. It shows the estimated average intake of fluoride from all sources at 1 part per million in drinking water for various age ranges. Now, I've circled this point at the top. That is bottle-fed infants. The line across is the safe reference dose as determined by the EPA. And so you can see a bottle-fed baby is exceeding the EPA's safe reference dose. Why is that being ignored by the ADA, the CDC, and other agencies? American children are being hugely overexposed to fluoride from several sources, not just fluoridated water. And this, the evidence for that is the increasing prevalence of dental fluorosis. Now, in the beginning, they thought they would hold dental fluorosis to about 10% of the kids. But today, 41% of all American children aged 12 to 15 have some form of dental fluorosis. And here you have it. 41%. 28.5% have very mild. They expected 10%. Mild have 8.6% have that, and moderate or severe 3.6%. But the argument which is most important, it would be reckless to assume that when fluoride is damaging the growing tooth cells, it's not damaging anything else, like the brain or the bone or the endocrine system. I am most concerned about fluoride's damage to the brain. And the weight of evidence, to stress that, the weight of evidence is not just the IQ studies which I should be talking about, it's the weight of evidence shows that fluoride is a potent neurotoxicant, i.e. it can interfere with brain chemistry. Now, first of all, the animal studies. There are over 100 animal studies which have found fluoride damages the brain. Damage to the hippocampus, neuronal degeneration, inhibition of cholinesterase, damage to nicotinic receptors, decreased brain glucose utilization, increased oxidative stress. All of these are documented on our webpage. This, I think, very revealing. There are 30 animal studies which have found fluoride impairs learning and memory. 30 out of 32 studies which have put animals in various types of tests, like the Y maze, T maze, Morris water maze, novel object recognition test, open field test, have found that rats and mice are less able to learn, less able to remember when exposed to fluoride. The beauty of animal experiments is that you can control everything except the one variable. So one rat is, everything's the same, same food, same cage, everything else, except the one difference, the one set of rats got fluoride, the other one didn't. And there you see loss of learning ability. Non-IQ studies in humans. I'm only going to talk about one. This is the, you don't know how to pronounce it. I call it the RO complex figure. Children are shown this figure and asked to redraw it. And then they take the picture away and they ask him to recall it. And look at the results from this very well done study in Mexico. They controlled for key variables, education, nutritional status, etc., etc., etc. The findings. Approximately 9 out of children, or 10 children, were unable to copy this picture as expected for their age range. And for the immediate recall, almost 6 out of 10 children were unable to draw the figure as expected for their age. So this is a preamble to the IQ studies that I want to talk about now. There have been 48 studies in all from India, China, Mexico, and Iran, and 41 of those have shown a lowering of IQ associated with fairly modest exposure to fluoride. 17 of these studies have showed this effect at levels lower than our so-called safe drinking water standard of 4 parts per million. This got major headlines around the country and around the world. This was a meta-analysis done by a team from Harvard of 27 of these IQ studies. In each study, the methodology was the same. They compared the mean IQs of the children in the high fluoride village with the low fluoride village. The study was published in one of the leading environmental health journals in the world, and they acknowledged there were weaknesses in some of the studies, not all the studies, some weaknesses there, but what they said is that the results were remarkably consistent. Of the 27 studies, 26 showed a lowered IQ in the high fluoride village than the low fluoride village. And the average lowering of IQ was about 7 IQ points, which is highly significant. I want to give you more details on one of the studies because I've been to China. I went to the villages where this study was done. I know Zhang very well. We just had him in Washington, D.C. He looked at and compared the IQ of children in two villages. The low fluoride village, the average level of fluoride in the well water was 0.36 parts per million, pretty low. And the level in the high fluoride village was 2.5 parts per million. What about 2 minutes to go or 1 minute?
One minute,
okay. They controlled for lead exposure and iodine, and more recently they went back and looked at arsenic levels, and that was not a confounding variable. They found a drop of 5 to 10 IQ points across the whole age range and a shift in the IQ curve. So here's the low fluoride village. The black and the mauve is the high fluoride village. So you see that shift of the IQ curve over. That's very significant. I should talk about the significance later. And I just want to show this one thing before the bell goes, that Zhang did more than any of the other studies. He subdivided his high fluoride village into five groups. Five groups with escalating fluoride concentration. So you can see it going from 0.75, 1.53, 2.46, 3.28 to 4.16. And what he found was as the fluoride concentration went up, the IQ went down. So here it is, a fairly linear relationship. He also found as the fluoride concentration went up, the rate, the percentage of children with an IQ less than 80, I just finished this sentence, went up dramatically from 9.52% up to 37.50%. So please remember that. As the fluoride concentration went up, the percentage of children who were essentially mentally handicapped went up dramatically from 0% up to 37.5%. And I'll come back to this after the break. Thank you.
I guess when you're really trying to push something, you take a little bit extra time to do it. I spent much of the opening PowerPoint talking about Dr. Connors, but it's actually the local anti-fluoride campaign that the people of Boyne City are actually faced with. Consider their claim, forced medication practice known as water fluoridation, right here on this public debate challenge. Claim made by the citizens against forced medication. Now, if ever there was an issue worthy of the U.S. Supreme Court, it's the idea of a local government forcing its citizens to take medicine against their will. This sounds like a huge unconstitutional infringement, doesn't it? If there was even a speck of truth to it, the Supreme Court would have been all over it. However, the U.S. Supreme Court has denied review of fluoridation cases 13 times, citing that no substantial federal or constitutional questions were involved. 13 times this issue was brought before the U.S. Supreme Court, and 13 times they saw it as an invalid joke. And I can't wait to hear how Dr. Connors spins that. Also consider the fact that to even present an argument before the Supreme Court, an attorney has to be the brightest and most articulate in his field. Even considering that, these attorneys couldn't put enough spin on this claim, forced medication, to get the Supreme Court to even look at it. Now, doesn't it seem odd that the local anti-fluoride campaign here in Boyne City, or in Traverse City, would try to sue the city to have fluoride taken out of its water? Well, there's a reason for that, and this has actually happened many times in the past. And the fact is, every time this issue has gone to court in this country, the anti-fluoride side ends up losing, every single time. And that's the reason for this debate. In a court of law, they would have lost, because in that arena you have two approximately equal opponents. In this debate, you have Dr. Conant, who's been cherry-picking through over 5,000 studies for 18 years, and you have me. This match isn't even close, and that's the way they want it. That's the only chance they have. Now consider the horrible health effects they attribute to fluoride. A few months ago, a local activist wrote a letter, and in it she claimed that fluoride was responsible for, quote, lower IQs, autism, hyperactivity, and other neurotoxic damage, including ADHD, memory loss, Alzheimer's disease, dementia, gastrointestinal distress, thyroid disease, arthritis, dental fluorosis, skeletal fluorosis, cardiovascular disease, and certain types of cancer, of course. Got to throw the cancer in there. The United States is lawsuit crazy, isn't it? I mean, we all know that. I mean, if these health problems are created by water fluoridation, I have to ask, where are the personal injury attorneys? They should have been all over this. There are class action suits going on all the time for everything from mesothelioma, vaginal mesh implants, tobacco companies, makers of saccharin, manufacturers of red dye number 2, the U.S. government over Agent Orange, but never once has there been a successful class action suit against the municipality for putting fluoride in its water. Yet it does all this stuff, and he says he can prove it. I find that astonishing. Never once has the U.S. court forced a municipality to take it out of its water. So where's this stuff coming from? Well, Dr. Connett here has been cherry-picking through these studies for 5,000 studies for 18 years, and there are thousands of variables in these studies. With those numbers, 5,000 studies, 18 years, you can probably find something to support anything you want to sell. But the fact is that the overwhelming evidence shows that water fluoridation helps to reduce the risk of dental decay, and the overwhelming evidence has demonstrated over the past 60 years that water fluoridation is safe. And here's another place this stuff is coming from. They're making it up. A local anti-fluoride activist was very fond of saying that, quote, fluoride is more toxic than lead and only slightly less toxic than arsenic. I've seen it in print twice, and I've heard her publicly say it once. So I pointed out the fact that the EPA allows 4 parts per million of fluoride in drinking water. The EPA allows 0.015 parts per million of lead in drinking water, and 0.010 parts per million of arsenic. Now, what this means is that the EPA allows 267 times the amount of fluoride in drinking water as lead, and it allows 400 times the amount of fluoride in drinking water as arsenic. Well, she'd never heard this before, so she contacted Dr. Connett to ask him about it. Now, this is the actual question from the email she sent him, and she sent it to me because she wanted me to become enlightened by the words of Dr. Connett here. Quote, he, meaning me, he said lead and arsenic are very much more toxic than fluoride. I have read, written, and spoke publicly that fluoride is more toxic than lead and only slightly less toxic than arsenic. Is this wrong? Unquote. I couldn't believe it when I read this. You mean you don't really know? This lady is trying to influence a public policy that has to do with the public's health, and she's making claims and she doesn't even know that they're true. You've got to be kidding me. Why are we even here? You can't debate something that's already been proven. We're here because he wants to squash me in front of you and win the debate. If we were in a court of law, it would be equal. I'm way out of my league with this guy, I'll admit it. And that's exactly what's going on here. That's all I've got.
Well, David, the reason that you're out of your league is the people that should have been debating this, that the leaders of the American Dental Association, representatives of government, from the Michigan State, whatever, they refused to debate. And you courageously came in and filled the gap. Don't complain now because you're outmatched. That was your choice.
No complaints.
Now, I would like, could you switch off the light, please? I would like your response to this quote. This is from the ADA. You listed a bunch of organizations that you clearly respect, David.
Is this the part where he asked me questions?
Yes, this is the last time I'm asking you questions, and this is the questions. This is a statement from the ADA, one of the organizations that you regard fairly and respect. It says, individual dentists must be convinced that they need not be familiar with scientific reports of laboratory and field investigations on fluoridation to be effective participants in the promotion program, and that non-participation is overt neglect of professional responsibility. I don't know how much you know about professionalism, but that to me is an upside-down definition of professionalism. You don't need to know the science of your subject to go out there and promote fluoridation. And if you don't do it, you're neglecting your professional responsibility. What is your response to that statement?
Well, my response is that if I see a quote like that coming from you, the first thing that I would do is I would verify its authenticity.
Well, do that. You can look up the white paper. I can make it available to you.
1979.
Now, it's assuming that I haven't lied, David. I'm not making it up. And you do find that that's an exact quote. What is your reaction to it?
I don't have a reaction. I'm not a dentist. I'm just here to answer your question to a local Boyne City citizen. And you challenged him to find problems with everything that you said.
Could you stick to the question that I asked you? You're not fazed by that at all. I mean, you listen to this organization, you quote them, and yet here's an example of terrible professionalism. Next question.
1979, is that what that says?
Yeah. Okay. I don't think anything's changed, but you may be able to convince me otherwise. Center for Disease Control, I think you referred to them. Tell me what you know about the Center of Disease Control and fluoridation. Who at the Center of Disease Control talks about fluoridation?
I know that there's an oral health division at the Center of Disease Control. It has about 30 employees.
Okay.
National fluoridation engineer. You have quoted, actually you've misquoted the National Fluoridation. I'm glad you brought that up again. But you have misquoted the National Fluoridation Engineer, who was then named Thomas Reeves.
Okay.
The person now is Thomas...
Dijon.
I'm trying to answer your question.
Okay, but do that, please. Okay.
The fellow is Kip Dijon, and that's about all I know, sir.
Okay, all right, so basically, the only people that say anything about fluoridation at the Center of Disease Control, which has 20,000 employees, and they have toxicologists and they have medical experts, is this group called the Oral Health Division, which is primarily made up of dentists, and their mission is to promote fluoridation.
Mr. Dijon is not a dentist.
He's an engineer, but he promotes fluoridation. He's one engineer out of all those people.
But he leads the program.
No, the guy that leads the program is the director of the Oral Health Division.
It's not the National Fluoridation Engineer.
No, but what we've established here is people go around quoting, the CDC says that fluoridation is one of the top 10 public health achievements of the 20th century. And people are impressed by that because they're thinking that the CDC is 20,000 people with highly qualified medical experts. But it turns out to be a bunch of dentists who are promoters of fluoridation.
And an engineer.
Yeah. Okay. One engineer out of 20,000. Okay. Now, I've got 1 minute. So, do you know anything about this statement, where this statement that fluoridation is one of the top 10 public health achievements of the 20th century? Do you know who wrote that statement?
I know what I've read from you about that statement.
Well, because you don't trust that.
Of course not.
Okay. So who wrote it then?
I don't have it at my fingertips. I don't remember where it came from exactly.
Well, would it surprise you to find out it was only two people?
I do remember that.
Okay.
That's what you said, yes.
And one of them was a dentist who'd never written anything on fluoridation before, and the other one was an economist. And hardly a day goes by that that statement is not being made by some editor or some journalist or some health official or some doctor, and is impressing the worldwide public that the Center for Disease Control says that fluoridation is one of the top 10 public health achievements. But when you look below the surface, you find it's just written by two people, unqualified people. Doesn't that surprise you?
Are we done?
It doesn't surprise
you. No.
Okay. Alrighty. I need to pick up where I left off. No, we're going to keep the lights off, but I need to get to the place where I finish. So we were looking at Zhang's studies, where he showed that as the fluoride concentration in these subgroups went up, the IQ went down in almost a linear fashion, and the percentage of children who were mentally handicapped or borderline mentally handicapped went up also in a linear fashion. Very striking. Now, the lowest level at which this lowering of IQ occurred was 1.54 parts per million with a standard deviation of 0.27. If you subtract the 0.27, there were some children whose IQ was lowered at 1.26 parts per million. That leaves absolutely no margin of safety to protect all the children in the United States drinking fluoridated water. You normally need a safety factor of 10 to take into account the wide variation in sensitivity in a large population. That is pretty standard. You would definitely need it in this case because you were looking at a small study of Chinese children which wouldn't take into account the full range of ethnic differences, dietary differences, and everything else. So no margin of safety to protect children drinking fluoridated water. Grandjean, Philip Grandjean, who's well known for his work on mercury, said that fluoride seems to fit in with lead, mercury, and other poisons that cause chemical brain drain. And now I'd like to get to the significance of what happens when you get a shift in the IQ of a whole population, which is what you saw with the Zhang study. IQ is normally distributed, which means that the average person will have an IQ in that area of 100. But it's the two tails we'll be concerned of. The green area is the area under the curve, which is the fraction of children who are very bright or geniuses. And the mauve curve is the fraction of the children who are mentally handicapped. Now, if you shift the whole curve over by just 5 IQ points, which we probably did when we had lead and gasoline, you don't notice much of a difference with the average person. A parent wouldn't notice the difference between a child with an IQ of 100 or an IQ of 95, nor would a school teacher. But look what happens to the two tails. If you shift the IQ over by 5 IQ points, you halve the number of very bright or geniuses in your society, and you double the number of mentally handicapped. That has huge ramifications for a country like the United States, both economically and socially. And if you have any inkling that a substance out there is causing this, or might cause it, precautionary principle, might be causing it, you do everything that you can to stop the production of that substance. In this particular case, it's as easy as turning off a tap. Turning off a tap and it's over. We don't normally have that luxury. And so to continue to push this using rhetorical devices and all kinds of accusations, instead of focusing on the science, to me is irresponsible. Now we know that the target for fluoridation is children of low income families. The last people, the last children in this country that need a few more IQ points taken away from them are children from low income families. And I hope, David, when you get a chance to talk, you will provide the audience and me with some scientific evidence that allows you to completely ignore all this. Or are you just happy to continue adding this neurotoxic substance to the drinking water and assume that it's Dr. Collett that's misquoting, misrepresenting, and do all the other dreadful things I'm supposed to do? Is it me the problem, or is it not the science that I'm talking about that is the problem for you and for this country? Now, I hope that someone will ask me a question about this table from Zhang. Zhang produced this table in Washington, D.C. Just a few weeks ago. It's a table of all his results. It has huge significance for the future of fluoridation in this country. I don't have time to talk about it now, but when the question time, somebody please ask me about this table. But fluoridation is ineffective. You would think, would you not, that at the very least this thing would work. If you're going to take all these risks with the kids' brains, at least it would work. Well, the evidence is very weak. First of all, they've never done a randomized controlled trial, which is the gold standard for epidemiology. Secondly, the CDC's evidence from 1999 is incredibly weak. There's little difference in tooth decay in 12-year-old children between fluoridated and non-fluoridated countries. I've already shown you the graphs for that. The largest survey in the United States doesn't show much of a difference. And the most precise study in the United States has some really disturbing results, and those two studies have been financed by the U.S. government. So no RCT after 70 years. This is inexcusable, absolutely inexcusable. It's your practice, your government's practice. Why on earth haven't they done the standard test to determine that something, that fluoridation, swallowing fluoride is effective? Now, this is the graph that appears in the Center of Disease Control report, which is used all over the world to say that fluoridation is one of the top 10 public health achievements of the 20th century. Now, look at that curve. The blue line is the decayed missing filled teeth of 12-year-olds. And you see from the 60s to the present, it's coming down in the United States. And on the same graph, they put the red line, which is the percentage of the US population drinking fluoridated water. And the impression, and in fact the verbiage in the paper, indicates that the blue line is coming down because the red line is going up. But before you believe that, so this is tooth decay in 12-year-olds, this is the percentage of the population drinking fluoridated water, go back to the World Health Organization data. How can they maintain that with a straight face when tooth decay has been declining in all these other countries? And by the way, this red line here, which purports to show that fluoridation is working, is from the United States. This is their line, and if they just looked at the data from the World Health Organization, they would have realized that maintaining that that was caused by fluoridation is just utter poppycock. And I'll come back to that in my next session. Thank you.
And this is the part where I ask the kind of questions. Yeah. Dr. Conant, you've said that there is 0.004 parts per million of fluoride in mother's milk. It's a very emotional argument. Could you tell me how much chlorine is in mother's milk?
No idea. It's not an emotional argument. It's a factual statement. That means that all mothers on this planet, according to you, are deficient in fluoride.
You don't know how much chlorine is in mother's milk, and yet you endorse water chlorination.
I think they're two very different issues used for different purposes.
Both go into the water, both go into your
there's
body.
No, okay, let me answer your question. There's no chlorine in mother's milk. There's chloride iron. There is chloride iron in mother's milk. It's different. There's a lot of chloride iron in mother's milk.
The definition used to define fluoride as a drug is this quote, a substance intended for use in the diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of disease, correct?
That's a standard definition of a medicine. It's determined by its purpose.
You realize that this is only one of eight definitions. Did you know that? Of the word drug.
Well,
did you know that?
There may be other definitions, but the one that I think is the one that's most accepted worldwide is a medicine is defined by its purpose. A medicine is a substance used to fight, mitigate, or prevent a disease, which is what you're doing with fluoride in the water.
It's actually the fifth definition down. Now, this is a WebMD statement. Got this off WebMD. And it's about prune juice. And it says, prune juice helps, well, let me read the quote. Prune juice can also loosen bowels for if you have IBS, irritable bowel syndrome. Is prune juice a drug?
If the FDA was presented with prune juice and they were making the claim that it fought a that it was fighting a disease, yes, they would call it a drug, if that claim was made. But
no.
Then they would ask for randomized controlled trials to demonstrate effectiveness and also to demonstrate that it's safe.
Now, the definition you used was, it's a substance intended for the use in diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of disease. Now, prune juice treats irritable bowel syndrome. By this definition that you use, is prune juice a drug?
I would say yes.
Okay.
Yes. And by the way, the FDA, I think you respect them too, the FDA's classification of fluoride is it is an unapproved drug.
The FDA is in charge of water fluoridation.
The Food and Drug Administration is in charge of drugs.
Now, according to your definition, which is a substance intended for the use of diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, prevention of disease, isn't water itself a drug? Because it treats dehydration.
You know, I think you're getting into the world of semantics.
No, I think
most people know, I think most people know that you are treating water with fluoride to fight tooth disease. But that makes fluoride a medicine, as far as I'm concerned.
But according to your definition, a substance intended for the use, diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of disease, water treats dehydration, and it prevents dehydration.
No, water is a food. Water is needed as a basic substance that the body needs. I don't think I've ever heard it described as a drug.
I hadn't heard that fluoride was a drug until I met you. I thought it was a mineral.
It's a naturally occurring mineral.
But nevertheless, according to this definition, I mean, it's black and white. A substance intended for the use, diagnosis, cure. And this is what you're using to define fluoride as a drug. Water prevents dehydration, and it treats dehydration. Is it a drug?
No, I mean, basically, dehydration occurs. It's a problem that occurs if the body is not getting its basic foodstuffs. You get horrible problems if you starve the body of proteins and everything else. So I don't think you're treating a disease as much as you're not supporting the organism with its basic needs. You can't argue that fluoride is supporting any basic needs in the body.
Well, one of the definitions of disease that I intend to use here, one definition is a disease is a condition that prevents the body or mind from working normally. Dehydration prevents the body or mind from working normally. Therefore, according to your definition, water itself is a drug, and you're saying that we put drugs into the drugs to deliver drugs to the people.
I think, David, I do applaud you. I think you're very good with playing around with words.
But sir, you invent word
games. No, I don't invent anything. Let me tell you again. Let me underline this. The FDA classifies fluoride as an unapproved drug. I can give you the reference to that. You can check it out. Okay, back to my slideshow.
Does he go next or do I?
Oh, no, actually, Dave has a 4-minute.
Oh, he goes first. Okay.
Speech, and then you have 5 minutes to ask.
Okay.
I'm the water operator in East Jordan, although I'm not speaking on behalf of anybody but myself. I want to make that clear. But I had a lady walk into my office, and she asked me for all the records we had about the money that the government gives East Jordan to fluoridate its water supply, you know, because the government is in bed with the phosphate fertilizer industry, which I think is supposed to be giving money to the government, which goes to the municipalities or something like that. I'm not sure how the conspiracy theory works. But anyway, I didn't know anything about any money that was given to municipalities by the government for water fluoridation. I thought, wow, you get money for this. This is great. So the staff looked into this, and of course, we weren't getting any grant money to fluoridate the water supply. But it turns out that a grant is available for communities to fluoridate the water supply. The money comes from the health department. And the money is ultimately presented to the health department by Delta Dental Insurance Company. The Delta Dental Insurance Company gives grant money to communities for smoking cessation programs and for water fluoridation programs. Now, why would they do that? Because insurance companies do three things. They make money, they study data and statistics to help them make money, and they pay out claims. Now, they really like to make money, and they really hate to pay out claims. So what they do is they study all of the available data on any given issue to help them make money and to help them reduce the risk of paying out claims. This is what insurance companies do. You all know that. In fact, your car insurance company actually knows the odds of you hitting a deer, which I think I had heard it is 91-1. So the DDF, the Delta Dental Foundation, is one of the leading foundations in Michigan, Ohio, and Indiana, dedicated to oral health, providing grants totaling nearly $1 million annually. Now think about it. Delta Dental Insurance Company has paid out millions of dollars over the years to support communities for water fluoridation programs. They've looked at the same data that Dr. Conard has looked at, and they have drawn a completely different conclusion. Now the conclusion they have drawn is that community water fluoridation is safe and effective, and they support that conclusion by giving the millions of dollars to communities because the healthier your teeth are, the less money they have to pay out in grants. Doesn't that make sense? So the reason that they have drawn a completely different conclusion as Dr. Conant
is that in order to make money by looking at data, you have to use sound logic, you can't misrepresent the truth, and you can't go through and cherry pick studies. An insurance company has to be honest about the data they see, or it is not going to work out for them. Since Delta Dental is a highly successful insurance company, I think it is safe to say that the conclusions that they have drawn about the safety and effectiveness of water fluoridation are accurate. Thank you.
You've used the word cherry pick several times. You haven't given any specific examples. You have my whole book to choose from. But I ask you a question. What evidence do you have that gives you the confidence to continue this despite all the brain studies that I shared with you? And I didn't cherry pick any of those brain studies. I gave you the lot. Over 100 animal studies, learning experiments, IQ studies, non-IQ studies. What gives you the confidence? Has anybody told you that you can ignore all those brain studies?
First of all, am I allowed to answer questions in this portion?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. That's what it's for.
He's got 5 minutes to ask you questions.
Okay. Well, first of all, I trust my dentist more than I trust you. I allow my dentist to put his fingers in my mouth. And I also trust, and I don't want to say this disparagingly, but I trust the greed of insurance companies because they know what they're doing. They're being successful at what they're doing. And now you said you don't cherry pick studies. There have been 5,000 to 6,000 studies on fluoride. You've talked about 100 of them, which I am skeptical of anything coming from you, sir.
Well, you know, you're good at insulting people, but let's just stick to the brain studies, okay? I gave you the whole gamut of research there. Has anybody that gives you information, like Kip Duchon and the people from the Michigan Department of Health, has anybody given you a counter-analysis? This is why you can ignore everything the poor cottage is saying about the IQ studies, the brain studies, the animal studies.
You talked about the rat studies. Phyllis Mulineau?
Mullinex.
The Phyllis Mullinex study in 1995.
Yes.
Now what she did was she injected rats with 75 to 125 parts per million of fluoride. And there was a problem with that study in that there was no control group.
Okay. Just can I interrupt you a second?
You're
trying to answer. There's only one of over 100 studies. That was actually one of the first ones published, and the other 100 have essentially vindicated what she found.
Well, you just asked.
Okay. Yeah. So you got one study that you're content with because she used a high dose that negates all the other studies?
I haven't looked at. I'm not a scientist, sir. I'm just here because I read your work.
But, sir, you're not a scientist, but you are putting this substance into the drinking water of your community. You're putting in the drinking water, and I've laid out before you a lot of scientific evidence to suggest this may be causing serious harm. It may be shaving a few IQ points off the very people that you're tending to help with this practice. Don't you feel obliged to actually study these studies or find somebody to convince you that you don't have to worry about this?
Well, sir, I look at the laws of probability and I see a guy here in front of me.
Oh, no, I'm not the problem.
May I answer?
I'm not the problem. The problem is those studies. You can check them all out.
May I answer the question?
Yes, you go ahead.
Looking at a guy here who I've caught misquoting people on a few occasions. I've never caught the CDC misquoting anyone.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, you saw the biggest load of baloney from the CDC when they tried to trick the American public into thinking that tooth decay was coming down because the percentage of the public drinking fluoridated water was going up, when they could have easily found that that was nonsense just by checking the World Health Organization data. Either that was an example of gross incompetence or it was fraud, deliberately misleading. And as far as the challenges that you've made about misrepresenting and everything else, I haven't had time to respond to all of those. I can do, and I will do. But I think you seem to, again, the problem I see with you is that you think the problem are with citizens and with opponents of fluoridation. And you don't think you're obliged to actually address the science. Instead of nitpicking semantics, address the science and persuade the public that there's no need to be concerned about lowering of IQ or all these studies because they're a bunch of rubbish or whatever. But you don't give me any indication. What you're what impression I'm getting from you is you're a good debater. You're not mismatched. You're a good debater. But you're nitpicking rather than addressing the central issues. Is this practice likely to cause harm? You say no. Based upon what? On what do you base your claims that it's safe? Because somebody has told you it's safe? Like Kip Duchon?
I'm looking at a guy who I've caught misquoting people several times. I have looked at 200 other people, 200 other organizations who have reached a completely opposite conclusion as you.
Yeah. And I've told you about two of the... What are we into now? We're into the next section, right?
And speaking of nitpicking, nitpicking and playing word games, I mean, you invented it with this book. Anybody who scrutinizes this book will see it all over the place. Okay, I'm going to finish up with a summary here.
No, I've got my last 4 minute speech.
Oh!
Okay. That's all. That's and then a summary. Paul has a 4 minute speech, and then you have a question. We're letting a little loose here. We like to hear you guys talk.
Okay, first of all, let me pick up some of the criticisms that you've made before I finish off the poor evidence. You criticized the citizen for stating that arsenic and fluoride was more toxic than arsenic and lead. This citizen made a reasonable mistake here, because in actual fact, if you look at the lethal dose for killing animals, the lethal dose to kill an animal is actually lower for fluoride than for lead, and slightly higher than arsenic. So she's correct if you're talking about lethal doses. If you're talking about chronic doses, then she's incorrect. But that's a reasonable mistake for a citizen to make. As far as lawsuits are concerned, there were three lawsuits, one of them in Pennsylvania with Chief Justice Judge Flaherty in Pennsylvania, who ruled in favor of the plaintiffs that fluoridation was unsafe. It was turned over for jurisdictional reasons only, but not on the basis of his ruling that fluoridation was unsafe. And they had the top experts in the world on cancer and so on. Two other lawsuits, the same thing. If you're interested in class action lawsuits, there's one going on right now. Chris Nidell. Look on the webpage for Nidell, N-I-D-E-L-L. He's got a class action lawsuit. And believe me, more will be coming. Now to go back to my, could you put the, we've done the largest survey. This is US government funded, largest survey of tooth decay carried out in the United States. They looked at 39,000 in children in 84 communities. And in table 6 of this report, Brunel and Carlos compared the tooth decay of children who lived all their lives in a fluoridated community with children who lived all their lives in a non-fluoridated community. And their measure of tooth decay was decayed, missing, and filled surfaces. There are 128 surfaces in a child's mouth when they've all erupted. And they found the average for children 5 to 17 who lived all their lives in a fluoridated community was 2.8 decayed, missing, and filled surfaces. That's less than 1 tooth. And children who lived all their lives in a non-fluoridated community was 3.4. And if you subtract 2.8 to the 3.4, the magnificent saving is 0.6 of one tooth surface. That is not very large, but to make matters worse, they didn't even demonstrate this saving of 0.6 of a tooth surface was actually statistically significant. So much for a government study which cost the taxpayers at least $4 million. Now, also funded by the US government, was the most precise study ever done in this country. It's the famous Iowa study where they've been tracking children from birth. And in this case, they were able to calculate or estimate the total amount of fluoride that each child had swallowed from birth on a daily basis. And then they looked at how much each child had swallowed of fluoride, and then they looked at tooth decay. And what they found was they couldn't find a relationship between the amount of fluoride that was ingested by an individual and where they lined up with tooth decay. And this is what they said. They said, these findings suggest that achieving a caries-free status may have relatively little to do with fluoride intake, government-funded study, and yet we are still putting fluoride in the drinking water, having concluded that. There are better ways of fighting tooth decay in low-income families. So I'll start this fluoridation. Again, this is my summation. Fluoridation is unusual, it's unnatural, it is unethical, it is unnecessary, it is unsafe, it is ineffective. I've just been through that. And other countries have demonstrated that there are other and better ways of fighting tooth decay without forcing water fluoridation on the whole population. This is where taxpayers' money should be going, to find out what those other methods are. Now, I'm not sure about the time. Did you ring a bell?
Dave has 5 minutes to question you.
Did I have
then, and then it's a summation.
Okay, all right.
And we'll give Dave a few more minutes there because that's he wants it.
I probably won't take the 5 minutes. I'm curious about something. Talk a lot about studies. Have you ever conducted a study on fluoridation?
No, I've reviewed the literature, just like the two CDC people reviewed the literature. You take that seriously because they have CDC after their names. But I've spent far more time than those two individuals reviewing the literature after 18 years. And no, I haven't formally published any of those studies in the peer-reviewed journals that you would like me to publish in. But you've got a 350-page book of my review of the literature, aided by two other professors. And your colleagues cannot produce a written response to that book, nor can they come out in public and debate me.
And the second question I have is, have you ever had to get inside someone's mouth and work on rotten teeth?
No, I've never done that, thank God.
Okay, that's all I have.
Well.
Okay, you each have 5 minutes for summation, starting with Dave.
Okay. I'll try to answer one of your questions in summation. So. Salem, Massachusetts in the 1620s, Germany in the late 1930s and early 40s, and Boyne City, Michigan in 2014 have something in common. All of these are examples of people against whom scare tactics and misinformation were used to frighten them into doing something that was ultimately harmful for them. Think about it. Salem, they said, witches are the cause of our misfortune. In Germany, they said, impure racism, undesirables are the cause of our misfortune. In a letter to the East Jordan City Council dated June 19, 2014, a local anti-fluoride activist called Fluoride the Smoking Gun, responsible for lower IQs, autism, hyperactivity, and other neurotoxic damage, including ADHD, memory loss, Alzheimer's, dementia, gastrointestinal distress, thyroid disease, arthritis, dental fluorosis, skeletal fluorosis, cardiovascular disease, and certain types of cancer, unquote. Fluoride is the cause of all our misfortune. And from an email to me dated August 7th, 2014, by the same person, quote, if you read The Fluoride Deception, you can learn all about these great people who were paid to brainwash the masses to drink toxic fluoride. Now, I think the citizens of Boyne City are intelligent enough and rational enough to see what's going on here. Very vocal, very small minority of people are trying to whip up a frenzy of hysteria by telling you that you are being forcibly medicated by your local government. And again, if there was even a grain of truth to that allegation, don't you think that the U.S. Supreme Court, and I still haven't heard him spin this, don't you think that the U.S. Supreme Court would have been all over it as an unconstitutional infringement? And again, 13 times this issue was brought before the Supreme Court, and 13 times they refused to even look at it because it's a joke. Now, I'm going to answer Dr. Conant's question. Of these two options, which do you think is more plausible? One, that Dr. Conant is right, that water fluoridation is dangerous, it doesn't work, and is responsible for countless health ailments, despite the fact that 99.936% of healthcare and other professionals in this country don't take it seriously. And despite the fact that over 100 healthcare organizations worldwide, including the March of Dimes, whose sole purpose is the prevention of birth defects, endorses water fluoridation. And despite the fact that every time this issue sees a U.S. court, even on jurisdictional reasons, the anti-fluoride cases ultimately loses and the Supreme Court won't even look at it because they don't think it's valid. And despite the fact that Dr. Conant is often accused of misrepresenting data
sometimes even by the scientists who have conducted the actual studies that he cites. And the other option, this is the other option that is possible, Dr. Conard is wrong, that he has taken 18 years to cherry-pick through the 5,000 studies, a notion which is supported by the fact that Delta Dental Insurance Company, who has looked at exactly the same data that he has looked at, has decided that it is in their best interest to give away about $1 million a year in support of water fluoridation because they believe it's safe and effective, and because more people drink water fluoridated water, the more they drink it, the less they'll have to pay out in claims. And is it really likely a guy who uses skewed logic, misquotations, and misrepresentation of data is right and the following individuals and organizations are wrong? The World Health Organization, haven't heard you say anything about that. The Center for Disease Control, the American Dental Association, the March of Dimes, the National Down Syndrome Congress, the National Down Syndrome Society. He's saying that he's smarter than Dr. C. Everett Koop, Surgeon General under President Ronald Reagan, who said, quote, fluoridation is the single most important commitment that a community can make to the oral health of its citizens. Dr. Conant says that he is smarter than Dr. David Satcher, Surgeon General under President Bill Clinton, smarter than Dr. Richard Cremona, Surgeon General under George W. Bush, the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, the Michigan Department of Community Health, the Michigan State Medical Society, the Tennessee Department of Health, the Texas Department of State Health, the Canadian Dental Association, the Canadian Medical Association, Child Welfare League of America, the Australian Dental Association, American Dietetic Association, the American Osteopathic Association, the American Society for Clinical Nutrition, the National Head Start Association, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, the Delta Dental Insurance Company, the National Institute of Dental and Craniofacial Research. Is it likely that Dr. Conant's claims are correct and all these professional people and organizations are wrong? Community water fluoridation is also supported by the Oklahoma State Department of Health, Oral Health America, Oregon Medical Association, Pew Center for the States, Public Health Law Research at Temple University, the United Methodist Health Ministry Fund, the U.S. Task Force on Community Preventive Services, the Utah Health Department of Vermont, to name just a few.
Well, as I expected, David has relied on endorsements. He hasn't quoted a single scientific paper to back his arguments up tonight. As far as endorsements are concerned, they're very dicey on this subject. In 1950, before any of the trials had been completed, including Grand Rapids, and before any significant medical study had been published, the U.S. Public Health Service endorsed fluoridation. Within the next 2 years, a whole flood of endorsements, the same that you are referring to, came into it. It's a question of following my leader, in this case, following the public purse, because a lot of these organizations are paid for, get huge grants from these organizations. So these endorsements don't mean very much unless these agencies can produce scientific studies, scientific reviews, which stand up to scrutiny. For example, you've mentioned Delta Dental many, many times, but you haven't cited, for example, Delta Dental's analysis of the IQ studies, the brain studies, to show that they don't have to be worried about that. They haven't cited the evidence that fluoridation actually works. They haven't defended the various studies that I referred to. As far as everything, as far as you're concerned, hinges upon lawsuits, right? Okay, well, wait a moment. The largest law company in Canada is right now being used to sue Peel Region on the basis that fluoridation is forced medication. So we can all wait to see if that happens. Eventually, we will, I think, eventually find a court that has the guts to stand up to all the power and influence that your supporters have on your side. As far as this business about 99.36% of professionals disagree with me, about 98% of those, maybe 99%, haven't read anything on this issue. They're just going along with their professional bodies. If you go to the curricula of dental schools in this country, you find they only get one side of this story. And that story is that all the experts in the world, all those organizations that you referred to, endorse fluoridation. And all the people opposed to fluoridation, just like you, find the opponents are ridiculed. That's been the standard strategy, and that strategy is to keep people away from the literature. Our book, my presentations, are trying to get people to actually read the literature. You clearly have not read the literature. You are taking at face value from words from organizations that have been promoting this practice for years and years and years, like the American Dental Association, which also promotes the use of mercury fillings, amalgams in the teeth. And by the way, refuse to allow those to be called silver. They call them silver fillings. They don't want anybody to know that 50% of those amalgams are mercury. So they've been defending that nonsense for years and years and years in the same organization. The same organization that tells dentists you don't need to be in charge, know the scientific literature to promote this practice, and if you don't do it, it's overt neglect of your professional responsibility. You mentioned the World Health Organization. Again, is it like the CDC, just a small group of the oral health division of the World Health Organization, or is it the whole body? How many toxicologists were involved in the review? And did you know that the World Health Organization said, before you fluoridate, you should ascertain the total dose of fluoride that your citizens are getting right now? No community in the United States has taken the time to find out how much fluoride kids are getting right now before they begin fluoridation. If your group, if this city was scientific, they would look at what the dental fluorosis rates are right now in Boyne City, Traverse City, the other communities are affected. And if those dental fluorosis rates are over 15%, by definition of the promoters of fluoridation, Trenley Dean and others, they are getting an adequate amount of fluoride, and adding to that, you'll just get more dental fluorosis and nothing to do with dental decay. Tooth decay is a function of poverty. 80% of the dentists in this country do not treat children on Medicaid. That's a big problem. It's a function of poverty. And with poverty, you get poor diet. With poverty, you don't have enough money to pay for dentists. With poverty, you have poor diet. You have not enough time often for the parents to teach their kids to brush their teeth. When those issues are addressed, as they have been in Scotland, they teach kids to brush their teeth in primary school. They make sure they get healthy snacks. They're involving the parents in both the dental hygiene and making sure they get better diets. And for 10 to 12-year-olds, they've increased the number of children. This is in poor communities like Glasgow. The number of children who are caries-free from 42% to 73%. In a very short time, and this is saving them money. And guess what? If you put your effort in less sugar, you not only fight tooth decay, but you fight obesity. So what we need in this country is education, not fluoridation.
Questions, and we will take a question for Dave and then a question for Dr. Connett, one by one. So, who has a question for Dave?
Okay. I don't think this
is on. We don't really.
No, that's for the recording. It's not on in the house.
All right. You mentioned that fluoride wasn't medicine, and when I was pregnant, the doctor, I said I drink bottled water. And she was very concerned, and so I had to get a prescription to add fluoride to my water. And then after my baby was born, I had to get another prescription to give to drops to give to my baby. And this was before I was aware of the fluoride controversy. So I want to know what your take is on that. If you have to get a prescription to get fluoride, how it can't be a medicine.
We're talking about water fluoridation here, and you're talking about, I think, supplements or something like that.
No, it was pure fluoride.
Fluoridated water.
It was fluoride drops. By a prescription.
But we're talking about putting water in community, fluoride into a community water supply. No. That's what we're talking about. You're talking about fluoride.
Putting medicine into water. That's what fluoride into water. Fluoride into water. I don't see the difference between getting a prescription for fluoride to give to my child and you saying that fluoride isn't a medicine that we're putting into the water.
First of all,
Because that's why I was. But he said that it wasn't medicine.
I can answer your question.
But he said that it wasn't medicine. And if I have to get a prescription...
I understand the question. I don't know what it was that you were prescribed, and I don't know...
It's fluoride. If she's on a well...
What I'm saying is that I don't know what the concentration of what it was that you were prescribed. What goes into your...
It was a prescription.
Well, was it one part per million of water?
It was something that I couldn't just go and get because I had to get a prescription. I couldn't go into a store or a drugstore and get it. I had to get a prescription like Vicodin or whatever else is medicine.
I understand that your doctor prescribed something for you. It wasn't fluoridated water that he prescribed to you. What he gave you was something of a much higher concentration. I don't know. I don't know what he gave you.
Medicine.
We have somebody here. Perhaps we can get an answer over here.
Maybe.
She wants an answer.
I object. Well, let's hear from the speakers and
the
questioners.
All right. Question for Dr. Conant.
Thank you.
Let me just add a little postscript to that. If you look at the back of tube of toothpaste in the United States, it says drug facts.
Right,
and it says only use the recommended amount, which is a pea-sized amount. And if you look at the pea-sized, I think there's an exhibition at the back here. A pea-sized amount of fluoridated toothpaste is a quarter of a milligram. That's equivalent to one glass of water. And it says if you should accidentally swallow more than the recommended dose, get medical help or contact a poison control center.
That's the equivalent fluoride of
one glass of water. And that's from the FDA.
Yeah. There was an overdose warning on there.
Yeah.
Just a little bottle like this. If consumed too much, contact poison control. Again, medicine.
Okay. Question for Dr. Conant.
I'm just really wondering if there's any other dental professionals here. I've been in the dental field for 30 years as a dental assistant. To answer your question, it's because you're on well water.
I'm on city water.
Okay, then
ask a question.
But she was drinking bottled water.
That's right. You're supposed to be asking him a question.
So in regards to, you're talking about over-fluoridation, correct?
No, I'm not. I'm talking
so
about...
Any parts per million, you're saying, causes brain damage, is that correct?
I'm saying the lowest level, which lowered IQ in this Chinese study, one of the best, was 1.26 parts per million. And I'm saying that that offers no adequate margin of safety to protect all our children drinking water at one part per million, or even 0.7 parts per million, because Dave can control the concentration, but he can't control the dose. So some kids in America are going to be drinking more water than those Chinese kids. And by the way, there were two differences in that Chinese study. Most of those Chinese children were not using fluoridated toothpaste. And most of those Chinese children were not being bottle-fed, they were being breastfed. So there's every reason to believe that American children are getting higher doses than the doses which caused a lowering of IQ in China.
Most of the countries that you had up there on your fluoridation not to be fluoridated have health benefits for everybody. It's a country where they don't pay for health insurance. People come to those schools, give the children fluoride, give them toothbrushing instructions. They don't have as much, I'm trying to think how to put this, they get just as much fluoride there, but it's in the school systems. They're going in there, they're giving it to them there. They're not...
To swallow?
Not every day,
Or to brush on their teeth?
Both, I would assume.
You assume?
I would assume.
Well, why don't you look at the Scottish program? Because their program is to teach kids how to brush their teeth and get a better diet. And if indeed it's because they are spending more money in these countries on dental care, then shouldn't we copy them? Shouldn't we put our money into education, not fluoridation?
Every parent has that obligation to teach their child how to brush their teeth.
Next question.
Government could be helping, and the U.S. Dental Service could be helping. Do you disagree with me that 80% of dentists in this country refuse to treat children on Medicaid?
I don't know the answer to that, sir. If it's 80% of Medicaid
Do you know?
I disagree with the whole low-income thing. I grew up low-income. I grew up in the city of Boyne City. I don't know why somebody from the dental field is not here representing and helping this young man. I really feel like you have got so many great things to say. I appreciate you taking your time to come here, because everybody here just wants to hear the pros and cons.
Absolutely.
We don't want to hear about who wrote the book or who made the thing. It's just we want to know what is good for our kids and what is the best thing for the
community. I think David has provided a great service to us. I wish he could have done it without the constant flow of insults.
Question for Dave.
I don't think we should discriminate between the speakers as they're using their first names or their last names. So for me, it would be David and Paul. I have a question for David, but also really for Paul. The topical application of fluoride. To David, if someone uses fluoridated toothpaste, would that have the same effects, in your opinion, and accomplish the same good results as a fluoridated water? And to Paul, I would ask, does he recommend fluoridated toothpaste?
Dr. Connor just said, I'm not a dentist, okay, but I've looked at this stuff. And he said that the benefits of fluoride are topical, not systemic. And that's true. But what happens with fluoridated water is it gets into your saliva. So you always have fluoridated saliva. It creates a, I'm not a dentist, so you know this isn't correct terminology, but it creates a gunk. You know, when the kid comes home and he, I don't know, eats a sandwich or something, he's not going to brush his teeth right after that. But there's a little bit of fluoride in there, and it provides a benefit for that. And it, this is just my understanding of it. I tried to learn as much about it as I could. He's quite right. It does seem to be a topical thing, but at the same time, water fluoridation does provide that topical treatment, or topical preventative treatment.
To answer your question, if you gave me the choice between a country which had fluoridated water or a country that pushed fluoridated toothpaste, I would side with fluoridated toothpaste. Obviously, a more rational approach to the problem. Do I use fluoridated toothpaste? No, I haven't used fluoridated toothpaste for 18 years because I don't want to swallow any fluoride. I don't want any more fluoride in my body. I would look for other ways. Brushing your teeth is more important than brushing them with fluoridated toothpaste. Mm-hmm. Brush them, and I think I've been impressed with the data on xylitol. Xylitol is a natural sugar that occurs in strawberries and pine bark. And what xylitol does, we produce about 15 grams of it in our own bodies. It prevents the bacteria that cause tooth decay from sticking to a surface. And that way, they can't survive in the mouth. So it's a very gentle way of killing these things without doing harm to us. Right now, they're experimenting in Wichita, Kansas, giving children xylitol mints from low-income schools. A xylitol mint in the morning, a xylitol mint in the afternoon. Obviously, there's no resistance from the kids from sucking these mints, and it seems to be fairly effective. These are the kind of things that we should be doing. I'm also concerned that the ADA actively opposes the use of dental assistants, like our friend here, from doing some basic treatment, especially in remote areas and low-income areas. They could alleviate a lot of the pressure on our system, but the ADA opposes it because they're trying to protect their dentist jobs and everything else, and income.
Question for Dave.
It's actually for both. I have no experience I'm in the trades. But this is an interesting topic, and I think people of Boyne City should understand or know the difference in the fluorides. Fluoride's been said 1,000, 10,000 times today, but it's my understanding there's calcium fluoride that's natural in the water, and then there's sodium fluoride and other fluorides. Can we have an understanding of what is, do you know what kind of fluoride is put in the water?
I will answer that question, but I want to say something about xylitol. I have read a little bit about it, and My understanding of how it works is a little bit different than what you said. What I understand about xylitol is that it's a sugar that actually starves the bacteria. It doesn't cause it to slip off, which is, I think, what you said. It causes the bacteria to starve. So it's only as good as the next snack. So you get kids to eat xylitol gum, which is available everywhere. You can get it in this country. It's everywhere. Sugar-free gum is xylitol. I was in Afghanistan. I was eating xylitol gum, so I guess I really haven't looked. So, okay, I may be wrong about it. Maybe you can't get xylitol gum there. But anyway, my understanding of it is that it starves bacteria. And in answer to your question, the city of Boyne City used to put in fluorosilic acid, which is, now they say 23 point something percent, it's actually 19.8% fluoride. It's about a fifth of fluoride. It's cut, they cut it before they give it to you, so it ends up being 19.8. But in answer to your question, and then there's natural fluoride in the groundwater, calcium fluoride, and if Dr. Connor wants to weigh in on that also.
Well, this allows me to answer one of the charges made against me about not knowing about hexafluorosilicic acid. For about 100 years, the phosphate fertilizer industry damaged the local vegetation near their plants, particularly in Polk County, Florida, crippled cattle for about 100 years. And what was crippling those cattle were two gases, hydrogen fluoride and silicon tetrafluoride. And eventually, they were forced to put wet scrubbers on, a spray of water. And that spray of water converts these two gases, hydrogen fluoride and silicon tetrafluoride, to hexafluorosilicic acid, which is what they use here. Now, the interesting thing is that they can't dump that into the sea by international law. They can't dump it locally because it's far too concentrated. But one of the vagaries of American hazardous waste laws is that once somebody buys a hazardous waste from the chemical industry, it becomes a product. And you can understand the rationale for that, because you want the chemical industry to be recycling as much of their waste products as they possibly can. But once it's determined to be a product, it's no longer protected by hazardous waste regulations, and now local authorities can put this hazardous material into the drinking water. And it isn't just the difference between hexafluorosilicic acid and calcium fluoride. That stuff is contaminated. Is contaminated with things like arsenic, for which there's no safe level. So the dilution is not the answer to pollution. You're going to increase cancer rates in this country. And also, the same rock, this is extraordinary but true, the same rock that is mined for phosphate in Florida is also mined for uranium. And so you have trace amounts of radioactive isotopes also going into this junk. Now, just supposing for one moment that David and his advisors could persuade you that it was a good idea to swallow fluoride, even though the chief proponent of fluoridation, the CDC, says it works largely on the outside of the tooth. But supposing he was able to argue via the saliva, etc., that you've got to swallow this stuff, how would you do it? What would be the rational way of doing that? The answer is you would provide bottled water. If you put the fluoride into bottled water, you could control the quality. You could use pharmaceutical grade sodium fluoride, none of this hazardous waste junk. You could control the dose far better, because you tell people only drink 1 liter of this a day. You wouldn't be forcing it on people that didn't want it, so you solve the ethical problem, and you still achieve what they're after, which is swallowing the fluoride. That's a rational way to do it. That's a rational way to do it. Putting it in the drinking water where 99% goes nowhere near the teeth is irrational.
Okay, question for Dave. Okay.
Look out. We'll go up and over.
Okay. Oh, don't give it to him.
I want to commend Dave for coming today. I think it's awesome.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
That his name is David, because what we've got is David and Goliath here, just so happens I'm on Goliath's side. But
There's nine people on this little brochure I got in the mail. I don't think I see one of them here today. There's all these huge corporations that David's sticking up for in the back. I don't see anybody from there. David, don't you feel left to hang without even so much as a slingshot to go against Goliath?
You know, I'm actually having fun here. But yes. I would like to weigh in on something that Dr. Connick said about arsenic in the fluorosilic acid. And the NSF does, you know, I have an NSF fact sheet here. And what they do is they randomly check fluorosilic acid for impurities like arsenic. Dr. Connick said, you know, calcium fluoride is safe, doesn't have arsenic in it. Well, there's arsenic in the groundwater. Arsenic is a natural thing. It leaches into, community water surfaces do is they check all the time. They check for arsenic in your drinking water. And if your arsenic is higher than 0.01 parts per million, which is 10 parts per billion, you got to get another well. You're getting it from the groundwater. And actually, the NSF standard for arsenic in fluorosilic acid is actually 10 times stricter than it is than the EPA standard, which is 10 parts per billion. The NSF standard is 1 part per billion. And I do have an NSF fact sheet, and it goes through and it talks about when they've done random tests and what they found, and never have they found anything higher than 1 part per billion of arsenic in fluorosilic acid.
Question. I have a question, rather a comment. You said that, Doctor, you said that it is a topical fluoride. It works topically better than systemic.
That's what the CDC says.
Okay. And so what you last said, your quote about let the people put it in their own water, I think that's a great idea. It would be those that choose not to have it. It's not forced upon them. And those that want it, you know, they can have that. Also, you know, in the schools, I don't know if there is a government-funded program out there, or if there could be, because I know when my grandson was little, they used to have this fluoride cup that they would take to school every day. And yes, they did over at East Jordan, and he was in second grade. So maybe there's something like that that's out there for those parents that want to have that. Another thing I would like to address is if this is a topical and the systemic, I read, and whether it's true or not, that baby's bones, okay, they're soft and they absorb more, that this fluoride, that it goes into the bones of the child. It's greater percentage than in the adults. If this is true, parents, you know, we might not want that in our babies, because when we think back now, we see these ads, mesothelioma and all the people back then when they had the asbestos and all these other, they weren't aware that this was bad stuff. We are given an opportunity that perhaps this is bad for us. Well, if so, parents should be able to have a choice in the matter. And that's just something that I think that...
Thank you for underlining that bit of common sense there. But I have yet to hear a promoter of fluoridation give me a rational answer to the question, if fluoride was good for the development of the child in any way, teeth, bones, or whatever, why is it that Mother Nature kept it away from the newborn baby? Why is the fluoride so low in mother's milk? And I've come to the conclusion is that nature had no problem with the access to fluoride. The sea, the great oceans where life emerged, if you believe in evolution, is 1.4 parts per million. So there was no restriction on the availability of fluoride, but through all the twists and turns of evolution, nature has not decided to use the fluoride ion in any little bit of biochemistry in mammals, including us.
inoculations. I mean, you're opening up a whole nother can of worms. I mean, we get our children inoculated.
Well, that's a, you know, I mean,
I mean, measles, mumps, rubella. I mean, you're talking poison. You're talking putting something artificial into the system or not putting something
There's
artificial.
There's a choice.
And people have some concerns about that.
But darn straight.
Here is, I think it's utterly arrogant, especially by people that can't even come and defend this position in a public debate, to be advocating putting fluoride into the drinking water when they can't defend it, and they can't produce a written response to my book. This, to me, is the height of arrogance.
Amen.
This is not being decided by science, ladies and gentlemen. It's being decided by power.
Exactly.
You're looking at the power of the U.S. government, the Center for Disease Control, at the ADA, which raises $100 million, supported by the Pew Foundation, a multi-billion dollar agency, and the Dental, Delta Dental. But one thing I would just like to underline, not one single agency that you have quoted takes responsibility for any harm that is maybe caused by this stuff. Not one of them.
Maybe, because it's never been proven.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If there's no proof.
And that's what you're relying on. That's what they're relying on. They don't do the studies.
Information,
they
just
don't
like you
do
are.
The studies.
There's
they
many
don't
studies.
Do the studies. But if harm occurs, who's going to get it? It's going to be a toss-up between the local council that is persuaded by these prestigious organizations to go ahead with this practice. They will have responsibility because they're actually doing it. And the water departments may have the responsibility because they're actually doing it. But none of these agencies that are persuading them to do it are taking any responsibility for any harm. They don't even pay for dental fluorosis. Dental fluorosis, which is now impacting 41% of American children 12 to 15, they are not paying for the treatment, which could be up to $1,000 a tooth.
What is it? What is the fluorosis?
Dental fluorosis is a mottling discoloration of the teeth. In its mildest form, you see little white blotches on the cusp of the teeth, and then as you go up, one end of the range of very mild is cusps on the teeth, and then it goes up to 25% of the tooth surface affected. That's very mild. Mild goes up to 50% impacted of the tooth surface. And moderate and severe is 100% of the tooth surface affected. So that's what dental fluorosis is. And none does Delta Dental pay for the treatment of dental fluorosis? Do you know?
I don't know.
No, I'll find out.
What causes it?
Overexposure to fluoride before the permanent teeth have erupted. You can't get dental fluorosis after the permanent teeth have erupted. Okay?
Okay, I was wasn't sure the cause there.
Yeah, but it isn't just water fluoridation. The problem today is that kids are getting fluoride from many other sources. You're getting it from water, you're going to get it from the multiplier effect of beverages made in fluoridated communities, you're getting it from pesticide residues, fertilizer residues, dental products, mouthwashes. There's a whole bunch of causes for dental fluoride, but all fluoride, but many sources.
We have a question. He's been waiting.
Yeah. David or Dr. Paul, could you comment on the Harvard study on osteosarcoma in our young men?
I don't know that study, okay? But I would like to say something. You said this a few times. You said he's written this book. No one has taken the time to respond to it. And he'll answer your question, and I'm sure it's going to, you know, be negative. But so nobody's taking the time to respond to your book. I responded to the first two pages that I read. It took me about an hour. I showed it up here. People could read it. They could judge for themselves if I was telling the truth or not. And there was a lot of other things. My wife told me to bring a pencil. Yeah, I didn't.
It's interesting that you accuse me of selective quotations. You accuse me in public of misrepresentation or whatever on the response to item 18 in those facts. You didn't even read the sentence. It said go to chapter 6. If you go on to chapter 6, there was an analysis of the York review which supported what we said. We were responding in 18 to the claim by dentists that there are hundreds and thousands of studies which have demonstrated overwhelmingly that fluoridation works. When you go to the York review, they looked at all those studies and they could only find about six And as I said, the results were mixed. Of the six studies, one of them found a 5% benefit. And then there was less tooth decay in the non-fluoridated community than the fluoridated. It ranged from minus 5%, meaning a benefit towards the non-fluoridated, up to about 60%. Then they took an average of those. And if you read the whole chapter, instead of nitpicking on one and then misrepresenting it to the public, accusing me of God knows what. Anyway, let me come back to the question.
Osteonecrosis?
Yes. This is a fascinating story, because this is the conjunction of politics and science with a vengeance. At Harvard Dental School, Elise Bassett, who was a dentist, did her doctorate. And in her doctorate, she found that young boys, in a matched case control study, that young boys exposed to fluoridated water in their 6th, 7th, and 8th years, which corresponds to the mid-childhood growth spurt, had a 5 to 7-fold increased risk of succumbing to osteosarcoma by the age of 20, which is a frequently fatal bone disease. Now, it doesn't affect many children in the United States, but it's frequently fatal. Her thesis advisor sat on that report for 3 years. He's a known promoter of fluoridation. Here he's presented evidence that this practice that he supports may actually be killing a few young people a year. If industry sat on a report like that, they would be facing a massive fine from the government. But it was a chairman of the dental department. When she finally published her study in 2006, in the same journal, he put in a letter claiming that his larger study would not support her thesis. He promised it for the summer of 2006. Summer 2006, no publication. Nothing happened until 2011, when this promised study was finally published in a dental journal, not in a cancer journal, not in a medical journal, but in a dental journal. And what did they find? They used bone levels of fluoride at autopsy and biopsy. When the kid was diagnosed with osteosarcoma or died of osteosarcoma, they measured the fluoride levels in the bones. There is no way that you can use bone levels at 20, 30, whatever, to tell what the exposure to the child was in their 6th, 7th, and 8th years. In other words, this promised study did not refute Basson's study. So we have an unrefuted study that fluoridation may be killing young people. And this is a one part per million. These kids were exposed to fluoridated water or equivalent in their 6th, 7th, and 8th years. Absolutely incredible. Politics, politics, politics.
Anyone else that hasn't had a chance? Okay. Oh, this gentleman.
By the way, many of these wonderful, prestigious agencies were quoting this letter from Douglas as if it was a published study. They did this in Southampton, in UK. They did this in Australia, the NHMRC, Health Canada. They were quoting this letter as if it was a bona fide study, when all it was a promise that a study was going to come. And we had to wait 5 years for the study to come, and it didn't do what it said. Unbelievable. If you know the details of this story, it is far shocking than anything I've said today, because I've just focused on the science. I haven't got into the politics of it.
Doctor, how long have they been putting this in our water, and who usually makes the decision to put this in our water?
Okay, good question. 13 states in the United States have a mandatory fluoridation policy. Places like Michigan, Illinois, California, Georgia, I can't remember, Connecticut, they all have mandatory. So that's determined by the state. The state says if you're above 5,000 or 10,000, whatever attachments, they usually have a little preamble like that, you have to fluoridate. Ireland has mandatory fluoridation. Israel has had mandatory fluoridation. They've just dropped it. Israel has ended fluoridation. And Ireland may be next. But for most of the United States, it is a local decision. It's the local community, like Boyne City, Traverse City. This decision will go into their hands.
I'd like to answer your question. 60 years is the answer that you were asking. 60 years they've been putting it in your water, and the EPA is ultimately responsible for the regulation of fluoride. It's ultimately responsible for the fluoridation program. Now, Dr. Conard has said that's incorrect.
It's incorrect.
Now, in Michigan, the Michigan Safe Drinking Water Act has primacy over the federal Safe Drinking Water Act. And you've also said that in the Safe Drinking Water Act, fluoride is referred to as a contaminant. Well, Michigan is much more specific. The Michigan Safe Water Drinking Act is much more specific. It's referred to as an additive. Now, who's responsible is the regulatory agency in Michigan is the Department of Environmental Quality. The EPA is a tier up from them, but in Michigan, the DEQ is the regulatory agency.
Dave, I'm afraid you're wrong. In 1986, the EPA lost control over regulating additives. All the EPA can do is to regulate contaminants. That's, you can look it up. Now, of course, it's very much related, because if the EPA was to do an honest job, if they were to do an honest risk assessment, a standard risk assessment on using fluoride's ability to lower IQ, if they were to take that data and do a standard risk assessment, obviously the MCLG, the maximum contaminant level goal, would be have to set at zero. It would be very, very low. And if they did that, it would end fluoridation. So in a way, the EPA has an influence over the water fluoridation program. If they regulate fluoride as a contaminant, which they're required to do, if they do an honest job with that, it will end the water fluoridation program. But as they made clear on January the 7th, 2011, at a press conference, the EPA made it clear that they were going to determine a new NCLG, as suggested by the National Research Council in 2006, but they were interested in protecting children's teeth. In other words, they were doing something illegitimate. They are not supposed to allow a perceived benefit to interfere with establishing a safe level of fluoride in the drinking water. That's their mission. So they shouldn't have had any joint press conference with the Department of Health and Human Services. But again, that underlines the politics going on here.
In answer to your question, though, in Michigan, it's the DEQ.
Okay. Sure. Thank you. My name is John McClory, and I'm a voting Boyne City resident. I had to leave for a minute, and you may have covered this, but in my preparation for this upcoming vote, I read that the ADA has recommended that baby formula not be mixed with fluoridated water. And if I recall, that recommendation came out in 2006.
That's
Is
right.
that correct?
Yeah, it's absolutely correct. And there were two reasons for that. It came in the same year that the National Research Council produced its report in 2006. They didn't look at fluoridation per se. They looked at the toxicity of fluoride in drinking water. And their job was to review the EPA's standards. But as you saw earlier on, I showed you the figure which showed that bottle-fed babies were exceeding the safe reference dose. So that was one factor. And the other factor was that dentists, the Iowa people, Stephen Levy, had found that the first year of exposure to fluoride was the most sensitive year as far as developing dental fluorosis. So the EPA, the ADA...
American Dental Association.
Yeah, the American Dental Association sent out an e-gram to all its members saying, if you have to recommend to parents about bottle feeding, then you should use low fluoride or no fluoride in the water to make up the baby formula. This sent shockwaves around the country. If fluoridation was not safe for babies, then we shouldn't fluoridate. And so the ADA never took it that step forward and started to advise the public. This e-gram was sent to dentists. And I can't help feeling that what they were doing was protecting their rear end from liabilities so that they could say that they had this recommendation out there. But when we have tried to use, this is fascinating, when we have tried, Fluoride Action Network, to use the same language in that EGRAM to get warnings on water bills, and the first place we tried this is in New Hampshire, guess who opposed it? The local dental association opposed the same language that the ADA had circulated. So if you work backwards, I don't know the reasons for this, and this is the most difficult question to ask, is why? Why are people so adamant to keep this irrational process going, which may have many dangers, and even the promoters recognize that it works topically? Why are you forcing it on people that don't want it, expressly said that they don't want it? So you're struggling to find rational answers to irrational behavior. But for me, everything I see says they're working backwards. They're working backwards to protect this practice. They are more interested in protecting this practice than protecting the health of the American people. Now, if you can understand, if you can find the reason for that, I'd be very interested to understand it. This is the reason that they don't do any studies. They don't do the obvious studies that I've mentioned. They haven't. Doctors used to use fluoride tablets to lower thyroid function in Argentina, France, and Germany in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. We have an epidemic of hypothyroidism in this country, and no one is joining the dots or investigating to see if there's a relationship between this hypothyroidism and fluoride exposure. The second thing is we know from India and China that the first symptoms of skeletal fluorosis, you know, in India and China, they don't distinguish between dental fluorosis and skeletal fluorosis. For them, it's fluorosis. And the first thing that you see in the villages with high natural oil in the water is dental fluorosis. But if you stay in that same village and look at the elderly people, they've got skeletal fluorosis. Well, the first symptoms of skeletal fluorosis are pains in the joints, stiffness in the joints, and pains in the bones. These symptoms are identical to arthritis. There's a massive increase in arthritis in this country, and again, nobody is checking to see if there's a relationship between how long you've lived in a fluoridated community and arthritis rates. Nobody. And another thing which is not happening, you would think that when anybody was killed, when anybody had an accident and they had to have bones replaced, they would be monitoring the levels of fluoride in our bones so that we would know what the bone levels would be after living for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, 60, 70, now even 80 years. What are the bone levels looking like, and how do they compare with the bone levels of people, workers, and citizens in India and China who have had their bones damaged by fluoride? These are obvious things. They're really basic things. And then when you get this gift that there's a biomarker of fluoride exposure for kids before their permanent teeth have erupted, the severity of dental fluorosis tells you how much fluoride they've been exposed to. See, we've got millions of kids in the United States who have no dental fluorosis, millions that have very mild, millions that have mild, millions that have moderate, maybe not millions that have severe, that's more rare. But as the severity increases, you know that the kid has been exposed to more fluoride. So why aren't we using that simple, obvious technique and applying that to study of children's IQ, onset of puberty, bone fractures, thyroid function? We could be looking at anything you like about a child's development to see how fluoride is affecting. What have we done? Nothing.
I'd like to say something about a couple of things.
And then the gentleman has the pro fluoride, can you read what the 9 doctors and dentists said about using the water, tap water, to make up baby formula?
Okay, wait a minute. Let Dave respond first.
To my question, yes.
You know, I forgot what your question was.
My question was, my question was to confirm my
understanding that the American Dental Association in 2006 issued a directive to the dentists to instruct not to use fluoride, water with fluoride, in reconstituting baby formula?
Yeah, okay. I can't answer that question.
Thank you.
But I would like to say some things about what Dr. Conant said. Now, he's talking a lot about dental fluorosis, and that is exactly why I showed you pictures of tooth decay, because that's the choice. Dental fluorosis, it's all conjecture. There has never been, it's a cosmetic. There has never been any proof that dental fluorosis is harmful. It's nothing more than a cosmetic. I've never seen anything, even by him, of proof that it's all, what he says is that while it's doing something to your teeth, it must be doing something to the rest of your body. That's the conjecture that he's saying. The other choice is tooth decay, which we know is definitely a health issue. Now, he mentioned the villages in India. Dr. Conant, would you honestly tell us what the fluoride levels are in those villages in India and China?
They have found cases of skeletal fluorosis at as low as 1.2 parts per million, but typically over 2, 3, or 4 parts per million.
Isn't 9 or 10, 8, 9,
that's
10
not
parts
typical. It's not typical. It can go as high as that. But again, it's dose. It's a daily dose. It's accumulating in our bones. It just goes up. The more time that you spend in a fluoridated community, the more fluoride that's going to accumulate in your bones. Approximately 40 or 50% of the fluoride that you take in each day is excreted by the kidney, thank goodness. The other 50% or so accumulates in the bones. And that's what we're concerned about. And to go back to another issue, in China, in these areas of endemic fluorosis, they've examined the fetuses of aborted fetuses, and they found bone damage in the aborted fetuses and brain damage in the aborted fetuses. And it just might be in these Chinese IQ studies that the critical thing is the exposure in the womb with the unborn child that may be the biggest concern here.
Sure, yeah. This is for both of you guys, David primarily. Tell you a little bit about myself. My name is Mike. I work on video games for a living. Came here knowing nothing about fluoridation with water. It's definitely been a learning experience. Seems to me that the cons outweigh the pros. I've seen one pro regarding fluoridation, which is dental health. Can you tell me anything about the cons?
Besides the cons maybe. The cons are tooth decay. That's why I showed you those pictures.
Okay. It seems like there are more than just that with fluorinating your water.
Oh, what are you asking? What are the
cons?
Like,
yeah, exactly. Like, do you think the cons for fluorinating your water outweigh the pros?
All we know for sure, all science has ever shown us, despite what he says, all we know for sure is that there is a relationship between fluoridated water and fluorosis. That's the only con. Fluorosis is a cosmetic. There's never been any proof that it's anything more than that. He will say, he always says, it's damaging your teeth, it must be damaging your liver, it must be damaging your pineal gland, it's doing all this stuff. It's never been proven as it's a cosmetic. Tooth decay is real. That's the answer to your question,
yeah,
I think.
This is tremendous reliance on the argument that the only thing that's valid is done at one part per million, the level that we fluoridate. But that's not the way that toxicologists go. It's the dose that causes harm. And let's make it absolutely clear. I'm going to make a categorical statement and see if you're going to agree with me. What the National Research Council reported in 2006 is a large number of endpoints. And I have argued that there's no adequate margin of safety for many of those endpoints and the exposure, the daily exposure that many Americans are getting. There's no adequate margin of safety. But there is no question that fluoride damages health. That's been demonstrated over and over again in India, China, Mexico. It damages the health. And so the real issue, the real question should be, is there an adequate margin of safety? between the doses which have caused harm and documented in the National Research Council report and the doses that some people are going to get in a Floridian community. Now, interesting enough, I sent that question to all those agencies that endorse fluoridation. I said, by now, you must have had your experts read the National Research Council report. This is in 2006. I said, is it your professional judgment? Well, first of all, have you written anything on this? And is it your professional judgment, president of Schmuckety Schmuck, is it your professional judgment that there's an adequate margin of safety between all the endpoints that the NRC reported to protect all American people? I didn't get, I think I got six replies out of 50 or so letters, and those six replies just repeated the mantra that we support fluoridation is safe and effective, safe and effective, safe, safe and effective. I didn't get one scientific response to that question from all these prestigious bodies that rubber stamp fluoridation. And that's what it all amounts to. It's a rubber stamp with more about politics than about science.
Okay, we've got a question right here, and we'll try to move the mic around on this side. Carol McGinty, Boyne City. I'm a retired teacher, 36 years from downstate, moved up here about 10 years ago. A couple of things. Number one, I applaud you for the courage to do what you're doing, but I would also reiterate, stop the negative finger pointing and come up with more of the positive facts. Debate, I thought, was becoming a dinosaur. I am so elated to see that something like this still exists, quite honestly, because I think I am a person for truth. Get it out there. Let the people know what it is that they are voting on before they make a decision so it isn't done blindly. Since I've retired, I've become very involved in understanding what's going on politically, nationally, statewide, local, and whatever. People have not necessarily accepted what I've said, but I don't often say it unless I know I'm giving you the truth, and the rest of it's up to you. But I really feel, number one, this fluoride, it really ticks me off. Really ticks me off, because so often you just see fluoride. Oh, it occurs naturally. It's not all natural in this water. And I know it's not in right now. It comes from, you know, the fertilizer company byproduct. Okay, byproducts are sometimes good, but people are easily duped. You're busy with your lives, but you're being overwhelmed and bombarded by so much that's going on in every single realm of your life. It's impossible for you to be aware of absolutely every single phase of your life. And unfortunately, shame on us. You know, we thought the government was going to be working in our best favor. We thought the medical profession was going to be in our best favor. We thought all of these groups were going to be doing things for us and being honest.
What's your question?
Oh, I'm not there yet. Okay?
I
have a bullet pulpit, okay? But I will tell you, you've got to do your research. You've got to do your research. And one of the things that I came across, and I want to tell you, other than the book and doing your research, I had some questions, which of course I'm not going to ask. But this is a 44 page, I ran it off, and it is NSF, the National Sanitation Foundation Sham Agency. That, as Dr. Conant had said, in 1985, the EPA sent its experts, okay, and what they did was they allowed the NSF to have the standards
for all chemicals used to treat water and products coming into contact with drinking water. Okay, and from the beginning, the EPA gave NSF money. It's all about money and power. Okay, so look this up. There's a lot of information in here. A lot, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I've got to get over this. I'll be back, Ellis.
Real quick, and I apologize to Dr. Conant if I seem negative. I think I said at the beginning of my presentation that I was responding to a letter that he had written to a Boyne City resident, and the tone of that letter was extremely negative. It wasn't all published in the Boyne City Gazette, but I respect Dr. Conant, and I think he's great, to tell you the truth. And I apologize to him if he took offense at anything I said, but I was doing what he asked in that letter, and that is go through and find places where I've been misleading, and that's what I was doing, and that's it.
Yeah, but I think what is unfortunate with that, David, is that you sort of take one or two statements, which I quibble with, from a whole book, 350 pages, with 80 pages of references, and you left the impression with this audience that you could completely discount that book based upon these few semantic quibbles. And I think that is unjustified. But fine. You mentioned that I hadn't shown any pictures of tooth decay. But I want to show you, if you could just put the lights off for a second back there.
Sure.
This is from when Queensland, when the new Premier of Queensland came in Queensland in 2007, Queensland had never fluoridated the whole state. All the rest of the states were fluoridated. Only one town was fluoridated in Queensland, that was Townsville. But this was the promotion material, not of the Dental Association, but the government, the civil servants. This is Queensland Health, civil servants. And, oh sorry. So there's this picture. This is what teeth exposed to fluoridated water look like. And David, this is what you wanted to see. And this is what teeth without exposure to fluoridated water. Now give me a break. Is that what teeth look like in Sweden, Norway, Denmark, and in non-fluoridated communities in this country? No, this is outright propaganda. And I'll tell you what that is. And I think you'll probably confirm this. This is baby bottle tooth decay. And it's caused by babies sucking on bottled sugared water, milk, fruit juice, even Coca-Cola for hours on end. And it rots particularly the top teeth down to the gum. And this is what leads to extractions under anesthetics. And it's really emotional. It's fear-mongering of the worst order to suggest that that's what teeth are going to look like if you don't fluoridate your water. That's propaganda, but practiced by civil servants working for the government. Now, this is the leaflet, and this leaflet was sent to every member of parliament before they voted in mandatory fluoridation. And this is a medical officer of health, probably getting about $300,000 a year in Canada, and she is showing a picture, again, of baby bottle tooth decay, and implying this is what you get if you don't fluoridate your water.
First of all, Dr. Conant, I didn't show any pictures of baby bottle decay. I didn't.
You know,
but so, but and fair enough. Isn't that disturbing to you?
That's someone else. That's not our argument.
But this is a highly respected civil servant. This is a doctor that local councillors are relying upon to give them the truth about fluoridation.
Should it be in the water or not? I mean, this is neglect. That's neglect. People want to hear about
fluoridation. That wouldn't be solved by fluoridation. Right?
No, absolutely it wouldn't. Absolutely it wouldn't. That wouldn't be solved by, you need to brush your damn teeth.
That's right.
These people want to know if the basics of fluoride in the water or not. I mean, I just feel like we're getting so off track.
Yeah. Next question.
Thank you.
Well, someone mentioned money earlier, and that's what I'm wondering about too, because anytime you have a drug or a product or a chemical, where there's money to be made. So my questions are regarding, and maybe you can't answer these, I don't know. Well, for Dave, how much money does East Jordan and or Boyne City pay for fluoride, to, you know, that chemical to put into the water? And how much does the fluoride industry fund studies? How many lobbyists do these organizations have in Washington to make sure that the government continues to buy fluoride and continues to have federal laws that push fluoride? These are hard questions.
Okay, now they're easy questions. First of all, the first question you asked, it comes to about $1 per person per year. So it's very economical. The second question you asked about fluoride lobby, there is no fluoride lobby. I mean, we're talking... I've heard a lot about the phosphate fluoride industry, the phosphate fertilizer industry, and what Dr. Kahn wants you to believe is that there's no way for them to get rid of this stuff except in your drinking water. And that's simply not true, Doctor. It's also used...
What percentage?
About 65%.
65% are using water fluoridation, the other 35%. Can you give me a reference to that? Because I'm very interested to see that. I don't know if you're right.
My reference to that, I got a quote from Mr. John, that, and he told me that, because I asked him. And he said, this is what it roughly is, 65% for drinking water and solar panel fabrication, computer chip fabrication, chemical stock feed for other chemicals.
I do not think that the reason that we have fluoridation is because of the phosphate fertilizer. I think they're just a beneficiary of this practice, but I don't see them as the tail wagging the dog. I think you're closer to the mark if you look at the pharmaceutical industry and the sugar industry. The sugar industry said in 1949, before the US government mysteriously endorsed fluoridation, we need to find a way to reduce tooth decay without reducing sugar consumption. Then they put a lot of money into American universities to set up nutrition departments. The classic one is Harvard with Fred Steyer, to get these professors testifying that that sugar was a nutritious substance, that Coca-Cola was a nutritious drink, and at the same time pushed fluoridation. One of the classic ones is Fred Steyer, and you can read all about it in chapter 26 of our book, as we floundered away trying to find out why this continues. But the other one, yeah, I think the toothpaste manufacturers are very concerned about liabilities. I think if fluoridation goes, they've got $1 billion or so making fluoridated dental products. If the lawyers are successful in class action lawsuits, will they go after the fluoride manufacturers, the toothpaste manufacturers? At the same time, the ADA is concerned about liabilities because they have their seal of approval on all these fluoridated products. In fact, you can't get the ADA's seal of approval for toothpaste unless it has got fluoride in it. So the toothpaste manufacturers are sort of relying on the ADA to hold the fort, and the ADA is relying on the US government to hold the fort, because once the dominoes begin to fall, then it could be a problem.
We make money off the tooth decay. Why would we support?
You make a lot of money out of dental fluorosis.
$60,000.
Yeah.
That's good.
I'm
listening.
Yeah. Okay.
You're making great points.
Yeah. Okay. And now I've lost my train.
Sorry.
Okay.
The
pharmaceutical industry. I am not going to go there and suggest this is a conspiracy because I'm not there. But it is a fact that the most selling drugs in this country treat the conditions that people that are sensitive to fluoride complain about. Headaches, pains in the joints, painkillers, big seller. And in Canada, the number one drug is the drug that you use to treat hyperthyroidism. So that's a huge selling drug. So again, it may not be cause and effect, it may not be the instigator, but I think the pharmaceutical industry is a beneficiary of fluoridation with all these treatments that are going on. We won't know until it's stopped, and then we see some of these ailments decreasing in this country. But as far as lobbyists is concerned, the ADA raises $100 million a year. They maintain a staff in Washington, 20 people lobbying in Washington. And one of the things they lobby for is to keep the funding going to the CDC, to keep the CDC promoting fluoridation. And one of the things that we're trying to stop is taxpayers' money being used by the CDC to promote fluoridation. And as far as the pharmaceutical industry is concerned, there are more lobbyists for the pharmaceutical industry in Washington than all the congressmen put together.
We have a gentleman here, and we'll try to bring it up. Everybody's tired. Let's just try to get the last questions in.
I have a comment and question. My comment is that first, Paul started out as a Goliath. Well, I feel that you're like reminding me of Apostle Paul. You want the truth to get out there, okay? And I want to say that my question, does this anyway have anything to do with the Agenda 21 of the United Nations?
No, I don't think so. I do not believe. And let me back off a second. I think that dentists are very nice people. They're very reasonable people. I don't think they have a malicious bone in their bodies. I don't think they've got anything to do with trying to limit the world's population. And if that was the agenda, it's a big failure. or to dumb down the population, to make them more compliant. I don't go along with any of that. I think that the problem is that these people are true believers in this practice because that was all they were taught at dental school and medical school. And once they've graduated, they don't have time to do what three retired professors did, to examine all the literature. So they go along with the professional organizations. Incidentally, we meet many dentists who tell us privately that they're against fluoridation, but they don't want to say it in public because they're worried about the response of their peers and of their dental associations. Now, to me, none of that stuff would be necessary if they were really proud of this practice. If they were really proud of fluoridation, they would be here, not David, they would be here defending it and showing how great it was. Yep. They wouldn't have to. Bully dentists, either on mercury amalgams, you could lose your license. The ADA would take your license away if you extracted mercury fillings on the basis that they were a health problem. You could take out mercury fillings if they were mechanically failed. If you said, I'm doing this because of mechanical problems with the filling, okay. But if you told the patient you're doing this for health concerns, you could lose your license. This is the kind of bullies that you're talking about. And when citizens took the AD to court, they were sued. When they were sued by citizens for mercury poisoning, they went to the ADA and said, would you defend us in court against this lawsuit? The ADA said, no. So even though they were bullying these dentists and forcing them to keep using these mercury amalgams, when those dentists got in trouble, they didn't go to help them. I think that's despicable. And I think that's the same thing, David, that's going to happen to councils and water engineers like you when the sword of Damocles finally falls. It's you guys that are going to be held responsible, not the ADA that persuaded you to do it, or to kick Duchon that you rely on so much. It's not going to be those guys. Right. It's going to be the local councils, local taxpayers, and possibly the local water operators.
Okay, my last question would be, how far out from the city limits that they put this fluoridated stuff, you know, in the people's water? Like, out of the city limits itself, where does this expand? Or this goes everywhere, it doesn't matter.
At one part per million, I would imagine it Boyne City, I can't speak for Boyne City, but I imagine they have a wastewater treatment plant. I haven't seen it. All wastewater goes there. It's in the environment. I can't speak for Boyne City, but in East Jordan, the natural fluoride level is
below 0.2 parts per million. It's very, very minute. And if you're putting one part per million of drinking water, and I imagine they go through, say, maybe a few hundred thousand, maybe half a million gallons a day into Lake Charlevoix, into Lake Michigan, it's like putting a drop in a bucket. It's very minute. I doubt that it would, if somebody were to do fluoride studies now and 100 years from now, I doubt that it would be raised by what's being put in the water, very minute amount.
Well, I understand that in the city, you have no choice, but when you're out of the city limits, something country-wise, you have a little more control of people putting stuff in your well without you knowing.
I don't think anything would get in your aquifer from the city.
But like in Boyne Falls, I'm hearing that we get our water from the two ponds. Okay, so I'm going to go to the township and I'm going to ask these people to show me some kind of proof that this water is good to drink. You know, it comes in bad in your tub, your sink, or whatever in there.
Now at Boyne Falls, I understand that the fluoride level in groundwater is one part per million, which is perfect. Actually, now because the recommendation has been lowered, and you know, I don't disagree with that. It's maybe a little bit high, but one part per million, it's right where it should be.
Well, it's safe. I carry my water in. I really do.
Do you use a plastic water bottle when you carry it in?
No, it's a regular heavy gauge plastic, you know, like you carry in sports or whatever you do for the store. So I drink maybe 7 gallons of it. And I try to tussle that thing with one hand.
But it's plastic.
Well, it's not like your bottles that you have water in. It's heavier than that.
We know that BPA comes from plastic water bottles, which is real. That actually has been proven. BPA is associated with birth defects. So the lesser of the two evils, if you were bringing bottled water into someone in plastic, the lesser of the two evils would be to drink fluoridated water and use a plastic bottle to bring it in. Sorry, that's just what the science says.
I was trying to be safe for me because, you know, some of the things that he said there, I did a lot of my own research and everything, and I agree a lot with this gentleman over there. And so I'm going to continue to do my research and everything because, you know, I don't want a lot of this sickness that's going to affect my health itself. I've got enough medical problems now, you see. So I appreciate everything, you know, that I've heard here, and I will check it out with you. I hope that you have safe journey back home.
Hey, thank you. I would just like to thank this audience. I think you've been a model audience in terms of respecting both sides, no interruptions, no shouting, orderly questions, good questions, a very good example. And again, I applaud David for doing what he's done. It's absolutely great. It's a model for democracy. My hope is that this is a very emotional topic. It's going to get very heated as you get close to that vote. But you've also got a beautiful community here, and you don't want to rip that community apart. So don't make it personal. Don't hurl these personal insults around from either side. Concentrate on the common sense, on the science. Try to get clear answers to clear questions and avoid the public relations. And that's what I think is regrettable here, that because the other side has so much money to put out these colored brochures, it's money that's going to talk here. Yeah. And that's not the way this should be resolved. But I think you've been a great audience this afternoon, and I thank you very much for that.
You know, I'd like to thank the audience, too. I was a little bit concerned that I was going to be walking into the lion's den here, and you might have noticed I was a little nervous at first, but you guys were great, and I appreciate your restraint, even though you may have disagreed with me. And Dr. Kahn is great also, and he's made a long journey. He's probably tired. I'm going to let you ask a question.
I was just wondering if there was ever any research done on ways of getting it out of your body or detoxifying if you choose to do something like that.
Yeah, there is some, I saw a whole bunch of recommendations for various things like tamarind and other things. the frustrating thing about this is that we have many chelating agents for toxic metals. The chelating agents for lead, mercury, cadmium, lead, and so on. This is standard chelation therapy. But there doesn't seem to be quite an array of these chelating agents which attach themselves to the toxic metal and pull it out of the body. But there don't seem to be the same array for negative ions. Metal ions are positive, so that's where you get them. Now, the one hope I have, and I haven't had time to do the research, but zeolite clays, there may be clays out there that have a little socket, little hole, and it means the research, which into which fluoride will fit. And so the idea is you give someone this clay, and the fluoride would attach to it in the little holes, and then you'd crap it out. And it goes straight through the body, because you're not going to absorb the clay, and it pulls out the fluoride. So that's where I would look. But I did see, I'm trying to think where I saw this recently, about, it was in colored pictures of about 8 different things which people are recommending, herbs and stuff. But you have to be careful, because, you know, people recommend all kinds of fancy things. It's not as easy as getting out the toxic metal.
I think this is going to have to be our last question. Dr. Khanna has a big day tomorrow, too.
I assume both David and Paul would give the same answer to this question. So are there any issues of safety, health, or environment with production and acquisition of fluoride? Particularly, are there any greenhouse gas or global warming issues with production?
No, I don't. There are some of the fluorinated compounds like sulfur, hexafluoride, which might contribute to ozone damage because they're pretty neutral and they get all the way up, and then when they, you know, the ultraviolet light breaks them up, and then you've got the free radicals to start breaking down the ozone. But no, not the fluoride chemicals that we're talking about. It's very much a localized toxic effect on the workers that are handling that, and then the long-term health effects of people that drink the stuff that we're concerned about. Thank you. Great. Whoops. I'm not the chairperson.
Hello.
You said one more in this.
Dr. Corning.
Okay. Well, they got to get going, so, yeah. You know.
One more,
okay.
Well, there was a question that was answered.
Okay.
My name is Dr. Richard Ulrey. I'm the author of the book Minerals for the Genetic Code, Minerals for Tumor-Suppressing Genes, Minerals for Acupuncture Meridians, and an Amishman's Handy Guide to Vitamins and Minerals. The question about getting fluoride out of the system is slit on the thiamine is maybe one of the best. And since he was not taking any more questions, I wanted to know, in an area where thyroid is pandemic and we have a goiter belt, what are the effects of fluoride? Because I see everybody on thyroid medicine, they go on these fluoride-based pills or they move to towns of fluoridation, their thyroid medicine have to be doubled within 60 to 90 days.
Wow. It's quite mysterious how the fluoride ion and iodine interact with thyroid function. It's not an easy answer about the mechanisms. It's certainly not a simple displacement theory as sometimes people suggest. It's complicated.
Thank you.